Oh, yeah, Come Together, Aerosmith's version. Those guys dirty it up a little bit right there, Florentine.
Yeah, that's a great version.
I love that version of that song. I guess we play it for Joe Perry, who's resting comfortably with his family. Was it a heart attack? Or are you? Do you have the inside scoop on this?
It seems like it was, but he's doing better.
Right.
So I think it's not going to be... He's not going to pass away, it looks like. It looks like they got it in time.
You saw the video, right?
Yeah.
Where he just got really weak. And he's a true rock star, though, because he's still trying to play. And then he's like, oh, man. And then he walks off. He sits down. He's still trying to play. And then he goes behind the amp, I think. And then he collapses, right?
Yeah.
Lazy. Well, he's just lazy.
Lazy.
Sitting down.
We're not sure at that point because the camera guy was more into the song they were playing. I think they were playing a cover of Rebel Rebel by David Bowie. But all of a sudden, it's so obvious something's going on with Joe Perry. The guy, the only video we saw so far, it would pan to Perry. You can see he's having problems. And then this camera guy is moving back to the action, Johnny Depp and Alice Cooper.
I think maybe because he sat in the drum riser.
Right.
He was trying to get it together, and he stood up, and he went back there. Maybe the guy thought maybe something was wrong with his guitar. You know, right. So he went back there for a little bit. That's why he went back to Alice Cooper and Johnny Depp. When you got Johnny Depp on stage, you want to get a shot of him, too.
Yeah,
you
and he didn't know he was having a heart attack. Yeah,
no.
Afterwards, you're like, oh, that's what I was shooting.
I think the video that we were watching, the guy was just filming, like, the screen that they're always projecting.
Oh, so that was, yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't actually filming
on
stage.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Supposedly, there was a video earlier in the day where Joe did, like, some kind of, maybe a Periscope or something, saying, come out to the show, there's some tickets available, whatever, and he looked really bad. That's right. What my friend said. I didn't see it.
Well, he looked really bad when he came in here promoting his book, so.
Yeah, he looked a little thin.
He's 65.
He looked a little thin.
He's lived a life.
You know, how could you not love Joe Perry? But it gets to a point with all those things, all those rock things, it starts looking a little silly.
Yeah, they all do that.
It looks a little silly.
They're calling out Johnny Depp because Johnny Depp dresses like that now too, and he's got all the tattoos, and he dresses up already with the
leather bracelets and the rings, and the necklaces, and this and that. It seems it looks exhausting to put all that together every day to be a rock star.
I won't even wear a necklace because I'm like, I don't want to take it on and off. It's a pain in the fucking ass.
Talking
I don't even
about
wear
condoms.
A watch. That I'll wear, usually.
We certainly like Joe Perry, and I'm sure he'll be back out there eventually. He's going to have to take some time and see what's going on with his ticker, right? How is Johnny Depp? Is he?
He's good.
That's what everyone says.
He was in a band years ago, you know, before he even went out to Hollywood. He's living down in Florida. He had a band, so he's always been in that.
So he's been a legit musician.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's no joke. It's not like he just decided to do this one day. He's been hanging out with a lot of these guys for a really, really long time. And, you know, they made sure they filmed Johnny Depp instead of Joe Perry, because you gotta get all that goodness in.
Between Joe Perry and Alice Cooper, there's not a lot to look at on stage.
Right.
So you got to go to Johnny Depp.
Do you like Alice Cooper?
Love Alice.
Do you? I never got that.
I could see if people didn't get it. It was almost like the Kiss, if you didn't get it with the makeup and stuff, and Alice did the blood and the hanging on the stage. But
I'm talking about his songs. I mean, besides a couple hits in there, I never really got into his music.
He sounded good on the video we saw, though. His voice held up well.
Yeah, I think I'm in the minority. I mean, he's obviously extremely good.
No, he still sounds, his shows are amazing.
Yeah.
Sounds great. He's been sober for years. I think it's tough to get into Alice Cooper now. I think you had to get into him back in the 70s.
Right.
It might sound a little dated, possibly, if someone's trying to get into him now.
Sure.
Some of his stuff. But now he puts on a great show, too. Always has a great band.
And the Hollywood Vampires, they're doing okay. They were doing okay before this Joe Perry thing.
Yeah.
So, all right. We got a very busy show. We got Florentine here. We got Theo Von. He's stopping by to say hi. We got Tony Robbins coming in like 10 minutes. We haven't seen Tony Robbins in a while.
No, I think we've only had him on once.
What's the name of his documentary that I did see last night?
I'm not your guru.
I'm not your guru, right. He's promoting that today.
I saw half of it. I was just late. I had to go to bed. It was very good.
He helps people. He had a really shitty upbringing, a shitty mom that really loved him, But it gave him drive to go out there and help others, and he became a millionaire out of it.
I didn't know about his upbringing. That was interesting to me. I had no idea what he came from.
Right. She was scared that Tony Robbins was going to leave, so she tried everything she could to keep him from leaving, including going to college. I believe she even kind of gave him stuff to make him sick, that type of shit.
Oh, no, the Sixth Sense soup kid? Oh, no. Is he doing a little puppet show?
What kind of stuff? What would you give him to make him sick?
What is it?
Well, ask him. I don't know.
Yeah, what is the what is that disease when the mom makes...
AIDS. Dementia.
When the mom makes the kids purposely sick so she could take care of them. Munchausen or something like that. What is it? Yeah, Munchausen syndrome. I believe she did a little of that with Tony Robbins. And then he became a millionaire at 24, and now he's worth, I would guess, close to $100 fucking million.
Probably a bookstore and stuff.
You saw his mansion in the documentary.
Yeah.
It's easy to live a good life when you got that going on for you.
Yeah.
Did you see his little tiny trampoline he jumped up and down on?
Yeah, so he gets his heart going.
Is that what that's...
To get him pumped. I was...
Go ahead, sorry.
So his before stage ritual was interesting. He jumps on a trampoline, walks off, and he does like a weird spin. I think that's just to get his energy proper.
Right. It's just strange that they got to, move that tiny trampoline around for him. I mean, it's tiny, and he just jumps up and down real fast.
So right before he goes on,
he's jumping up and down. I want to ask him about it. And then, did you see the pool? The 57-degree pool?
I did, yeah.
It's a little square pool. It can't be more than I don't even know, maybe 4 feet by 4 feet. It's like a tiny little square, and it's over his head, and he just jumps in
to get there
and holds his breath, and supposedly the water is 57 degrees.
What does that do? I will ask him.
I want to ask him about that as well. So I liked it. I'm Not Your Guru is very good. A lot of people crying. I guess he does these conventions, these workshops,
right?
And you spend a lot of money, and you get some breakthroughs, and it seemed to be working for the people in the documentary.
Yeah, I don't know if it's for me or not. Then again, let's be honest, matters couldn't be any worse. couldn't fuck me up any more than I already am.
Might as well give it a try.
Yeah, Netflix is doing some interesting stuff.
I love Netflix. It's the only way to go.
Yeah, I think so, too.
What Chelsea Handler's show on there? Does she do, was it like 3 times a week maybe it's on?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Because that's the first one that's really like, a daily show that they're doing. Right.
I checked it out. It's a little strange, the Chelsea Handler show.
I didn't see the new version. I only saw the one that, like, one of the episodes when she was coming to promote.
I'm just saying it's a little strange. I don't know. Maybe I should give it a little more time. She's got her dog walks around the stage and stuff. The dog just runs free. And in between her doing kind of a talk show, also the dog will come up and she'll pet the dog and stuff. And the dog will sit down by her feet.
Who is she interviewing? Is it celebrities or is it like...
People trying to make a difference in the world, basically.
Oh.
You know.
I'm sure she'll ask me to be on.
and then all of a sudden she'll talk to Pitbull as well. So it's a little strange. It's a bit strange, but she's doing what she wants now. She doesn't have to fucking listen to anybody. Tony's here already. Tony Robbins is here. We just started the show.
Bring him in.
All right. We also went and saw Ghostbusters last night. We want to talk about that. It was good. And but just saying Ghostbusters, is good.
It was good because
makes people fucking pissed. They
when I saw the trailer, I thought it was going to be horrific, but it was actually pretty good.
As a movie, I liked it a lot.
Okay,
I'm not one of these geeky types where everything has to mean something because they're redoing Ghostbusters and why did they do it this way and why did they pick the female cast and why, that's up for other people to discuss. As a standalone movie, I liked it. I wasn't blown away by it, but okay. I liked it, and there was some humor in there. So, well, E-Rock went. We'll talk about it after Tony Robbins.
Did they use the song?
Sort of. Right, E-Rock?
You like that song, Jim?
No, I don't, Jim.
No?
No, I don't.
You don't like it?
No, I certainly don't.
When it just builds and builds and then all of a sudden...
Are you going to call?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't like it?
I'm afraid of no ghost. Shut up.
And E-Rock said
never liked that movie.
The movie trailers didn't accurately portray Leslie Jones either.
No.
All right, we'll get into the Ghostbusters discussion.
Oh, E-Rock has some real issues with the trailers. I love how mad Eric gets at the trailers. He's betrayed by them.
Real quick, the trailer makes her look worse than she really is in the movie.
What did the trailer do to her?
The trailer made
now
her
that
look,
I saw the movie.
Made her look like a stereotypical, loud, obnoxious black woman. But in the, throughout the whole thing of the movie, she wasn't.
Tony Robbins just walks in.
Hello, how are you?
Sorry, Rock, you just got interrupted for Tony Robbins. I just saw you on TV. Was that a live show?
Yeah.
And then you ran over here?
Across the street, yeah.
Oh, my God. How are you, buddy?
How's it going? Great. How are you guys?
Good. We saw the documentary.
Oh, did you really?
Yes. I'm not your guru.
Wow, that's impressive. Most people don't take the time to see it before they get some out. Thank you.
Well, I'm trying to be a little more prepared for this radio show. I figured after all these years, maybe I should prepare a little bit.
I'm going to have some entertainment when I come to see you.
I really liked it. Now, that I got to ask the dumb questions, though. The tiny trampoline. That's to get the heart going.
It's the lymph of your body. You know, the lymph is the sewage system of the body, and it doesn't have a pump. So, like, the heart pumps your blood. So it makes a huge difference. You know, I'm on stage for... One day I'll do 16 to 18 miles on the first day. That's a half day. And the long day, I go from 8:30 in the morning to 1:30 in the morning with one hour break.
Wow.
I do 26 to 27 miles. So I use the trampoline. I also use that cold plunge, and I use cryotherapy. It takes your body down to minus 240.
I've heard mixed reviews about that. Does that actually help? I tried it three times and it hurt my leg. My back of my right leg started to throb like it was being squeezed. I couldn't, I did it for about 2 minutes.
Oh, yeah. Maybe it's because it were cramping up. It could have been because of the guy you brought in there with you.
Well, tell me, was it cold?
Yeah, you got, I was just telling these guys.
It didn't help you, that major shrinkage you're having in the cold, right?
You got this tiny pool. It's like 4 by 4 feet, and it's over your head. And
yeah,
you just
56 degrees.
And it's 56 degrees, and you jump in, and then what? Hold your breath, and it just shocks your body awake?
Every more organ in your body just pushes the blood through, and then it gets all the lactic acid out. It's really great.
So it does help you think?
It helps you think. It helps you function physically. You know, I make pretty crazy demands on my body.
So, what made you decide to let them film you? Because you did never let anybody film all this stuff before. Then you gave these cameras complete access to your, what's it called? The
Day with Destiny. Yeah, I see about 200,000 people a year. And
how many?
200,000 people a year in 15 countries. So my average event's about 8,000 people, 8 to 10. But this event I only do once a year for only 2,500 people. And people do about 20 pages of homework, and I read all that beforehand. So it's a pretty intense program. But Joe Berlinger, who's got 7, you know, Emmys, nominations. He's won 2. He's got 2 Academy Award nominations, 2 Peabodys. I met him socially. I don't know if you watch Billions.
Yes.
TV show. Yeah. So, you know, the showrunner for Billions is a good friend of mine, and he introduced us. And so, anyway, long story short, I invite him to this event. He's very skeptical. You know, he makes all these films about the underbelly of society, the worst part of life.
Sure.
And he came out and transformed them. So he came back and spent 2 years trying to convince me to do it. I didn't want to do it because I didn't want people being interrupted in the experience, you know. But he finally said, listen, if it interrupts, you can shut me down and we'll end this thing and it's my loss. And I said, okay, we'll give it a shot. And he just did a magnificent job, as you saw.
It's filmed beautifully. Oh, my God. You got a hell of a house there, too.
Thank you.
Oh, my God. Life's been good to Mr. Robbins.
Yes,
but,
it has.
But, I mean, I'll go back to the beginning. I mean, your life wasn't that good.
No, certainly wasn't.
Which is quite fascinating. You had a very controlling mom.
Yeah. And she was pretty crazy and pretty abusive, but she loved me. She just didn't know how to handle the fact that I was growing up, and she was dependent upon me. She didn't even go to the grocery store. I used to go to the pharmacist and convince him to give her more Valium because she'd lost it and never realizing she was just overusing it.
So she had a drug problem?
Drug problem, prescription alcohol, and then she would... You know, pour liquid soap down my throat until I vomited because she thought I was lying and I wasn't, or beat my head till I was bleeding. But, you know, I said in the film, and I really mean it, that I don't knock my mom. I never talked about this while she was alive. But I wouldn't be the man I am today if she was the mom I wanted her to be, right? You know, all of my desire to end suffering comes because I suffered so much. So,
right.
Do you still dislike her for that, though? Like, you know, even though it's something good, it's like saying in Germany the trains ran on time. It's like there was something good that came out of bad stuff, but it's still, you know, it was still bad.
Yeah, it's still bad, but if I really look at it and say, if she had been the sweet, loving human being, would I be out? You know, I fed 100 million people last year. You know, I go to 15 countries. I work, you know, 18, 20-hour days. Would I be doing that? Probably not.
I got that message loud and clear watching your documentary, because a lot of people have shit that has happened to them growing up, and a lot of us will just obsess on how bad our mom was, our dad was, our living situation was.
Yeah.
And then through this documentary, I kind of learned that, but you also got to remember all the good that came out of the fact that you had that experience going on in your life, or that person in your life
you saw the film,
beating
so
you down.
There's a woman there, Sienna, if you remember, the young girl,
sure,
like 19. She gets up and says her problem that she wants to deal with is her weight, and, you know, she's like perfect weight.
Right.
She's ridiculous, right?
She really wanted to get control of her overeating. She felt like she wasn't eating right or at the right time.
Yeah, but as I dug underneath it, what it really was is she's been estranged from her father, who was a drug abuser. And so I got her to put it together, and I don't want to give away the ends of the film, but one of the things I did with Joe Berlinger is I said, if you're going to do this, you got to wait a year to publish this, because I want you to follow up a year later and show people this has changed. Because most people don't think change can happen fast. They think it takes forever. And people say to me, you know, it took 10 years to change. And I say, bullshit, it took you a moment. It took you 10 years to get the moment where you finally said never again, or it's over, or I do, or I love you. Mm-hmm. But that process is really what this whole thing was about, is showing people they can change fast. But I wanted them to also see that it lasted. And I knew it does because I've done this for so many decades, obviously. But the stories of where people were a year later is probably my favorite part of the whole film.
You know,
seeing how they've transformed.
Well, is there anything you have to do after, you know, a meeting with you and going to one of your, you think, is there a lot of homework after going to therapy or?
No, there's no going to therapy.
None of that.
It's all self-directed, right? This is not about someone. You don't become dependent. That's why I'm not your guru. Right, that's the whole title of it, is I'm not here to make you depend upon me. You have all the power inside you. What we need to do is just activate it. And people have things they want to, they think they're broken or they're challenged, and they're not broken. They just have some patterns that don't work. We all have patterns, right? Patterns make you fearful, patterns make you crazy or angry or frustrated or passionate or loving. And so I help people see that it's not them, it's the pattern, how to change the pattern quickly. And once you do, if there's enough emotion behind it, and these people are here for 6 days and nights, 12, 14 hours a day, quite literally, it imprints your body. You get a different conditioning. If you just have an intellectual thought, you don't really change. You just have a thought. But I tell people, most people are wired for stress. They're wired for frustration. They got a highway to anger or sadness, and they got a dirt road to happiness. So what I do in those 6 days is get us to wire our nervous system so that joy, happiness, love, compassion are things that naturally come, not something you have to work on. It's like building a muscle.
There's a lot of tears in this documentary.
Yeah, all laughter, too.
A lot of laughter, a lot of tears, a lot of cursing.
Yeah.
Were you always such a potty mouth? I was surprised.
But the tears are good, obviously.
Yeah, without a doubt.
It's a very, very emotional film, and people really having breakthroughs and then, bonding with each other. I would assume they
become friends for life.
That's what that's pretty obvious just watching the thing.
Yeah.
There was something else. You had the woman call her. I got to talk about some of the stuff that happened. You don't mind?
Not at all.
Because it's kind of spoilers, but,
no, it's okay.
You know, this woman has a problem. She's in a relationship. She loves the guy, but she's not in love with him anymore.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, Tony goes, call him and tell him, and then she calls in front of everybody. How many people were in the room? A couple thousand, maybe.
Yeah, 2,500 people.
2,500
from 71 countries, and we're translating 5 languages simultaneously, so it's like the UN.
Right, because she's in this relationship because she doesn't want to hurt his feeling. Blah blah blah.
Yeah.
Tony just goes, call him, and everyone like, and then on speakerphone, she has the breakthrough right in front of everybody. Basically, finally telling this guy exactly how she feels about him and stuff, that she does love him, but she's not in love with him anymore. And I got to say, it ends with him hanging up, but she was like, she felt like she had all this weight lifted off her shoulders.
Yeah. She was miserable. So, she's punishing him too without realizing it, right? Because she's so frustrated. You know, people, when they're in a relationship and they're unhappy, most people stay way too long because we're just so afraid of being alone, or afraid, well, what if it's the best I can have and I lose this? The mind's irrational. We got a 2-million-year-old brain, and what it does, it doesn't make you happy. Your brain's designed to make you survive, right? It's always looking for what's wrong so you can run from it or fight it,
right?
Fight or flight. And so happiness is your job, and most people don't know how to do that. So this is really about that. And, someone asked me the other day, I was on a show, and they were saying, how do you explain, the kind of person that would go in, like in Paris or San Bernardino or, down in Orlando, how could somebody do that? I said, well, I can't tell you who would do it. I tell you who wouldn't. A happy person. A fulfilled person doesn't try to kill other people. A fulfilled person doesn't try to steal from other people. And I think the thing that's so trite that we forget is that we take care of ourselves. There's so much more to take care of other people. If you look at, somebody like Robin Williams, 2 years ago, we lost this man. And all around the world, I ask people, how many of you love Robin Williams? I'm in Japan, China, Australia, London, Brazil. Everybody, 95% of the people raise their hand and say they lie. I said, don't raise your hand if you like him. Only if you love this man. They all love him. So I say, okay, great. Look at what he mastered. He mastered achievement. That's TV show, number one show, wanted to make movies, won an Academy Award for being dramatic, not comedy, great family, money. He had everything, and he killed himself, hung himself.
Yeah.
And so the message I give people is he made everybody happy but himself. So success without fulfillment is the ultimate failure. And so my mission there is not only help them achieve more, but have them enjoy their life. And most people don't enjoy their life unless everything's, quote, perfect. I got I'm fortunate enough to now have 18 companies. I manage 12 actively. I have a pretty busy life, 4 kids. I got 1,200 employees on 3 continents. We do $5 billion in sales from all these different companies I have. What are the chances that somebody's messing up right now? It's 100%.
Yeah.
So I used to, my happiness was so cheap. All I had to do was pick up my phone and my happiness would go away because there's somebody messing some shit up.
Right.
That's the law of averages. Now, so what I do is show people how to free yourself from that.
Is it exhausting to take on everyone's shit?
Well, it requires energy, but it's so fulfilling. I mean, you could see what it feels like. You know, one of the women there you saw, I'm sure, was the woman Dawn. Do you remember her?
Children of God.
Yeah, Children of God.
Brutal. Brutal backstory.
Did you see a documentary on that? There's a great documentary on Children of God where they do a lot of what she talks about is covered. I don't think she's in it, but it's really...
For your listeners, really so good. They know, this is a young woman who stands up. I have a night called Suicide Night.
Right.
Which sounds horrific. But
that's what I call my comedy shows.
I'm ready to come now.
Basically, you've been doing this long enough that you know in a room of 2,500 people, there's at least 12 that are suicidal.
Yeah, about a dozen on average.
A dozen that are truly suicidal.
Yeah, truly suicidal. Not I'm thinking about it kind of thing. Or they've already attempted. So the film opens with a guy that was one of the people that stood up that day and, you know, turned around. But then there's this woman and she stands up and says, well, you really want to know, I'll tell you. And boy, she unleashes and tells me that she was born in this cult and they raised their children to say, you're a soldier of God. And so the way you're a soldier of God is you have sex with all the adults. And they're like 7 years old. It's just like the most horrific thing you can imagine. So the transformation in her is one of my favorite experiences out of that. But every event I do, it's like this. When Joe came, he witnessed a woman whose face was massively disfigured and she was suicidal. And then there was a man who was blinded who was suicidal. And I put them together and had them heal each other. And there wasn't a dry eye in the place. This man's touching this woman's face, this blind man, telling her how beautiful she is. And then there's a man there that was just got out of Afghanistan, a Marine, and buried 37 of his buddies, shaking, like his hand shaking so hard he couldn't hold the microphone like this. Dark glasses because he got light sensitivity from explosions, migraine headaches, can't sleep. Took me about an hour and a half. No more light sensitivity. Took it off because you just retrain the nervous system. No more shaking. I brought him on CNN, and the woman who was the producer there, so we showed her the film of just, you know, not a documentary film, just the session I did with him. And when she walked in the room, she started to cry. Because he's so transformed. He's so different. So Joe's concern was, oh, my God, was this let I go to the best event? You know, but every event, there are these amazing stories. So and what's beautiful is to see them a year later or 2 years later and see how their life has continued to change.
And if they don't get that one-on-one with you, they're still getting something out of it.
Oh, yeah, because everybody lives through those people. That's what's beautiful about the documentary. First of all, by the way, it's on Netflix, and it comes out on this Friday.
Yes.
In New York and L.A. this week, theatrically, if you want to go to the theaters, it's there, which is kind of cool to see it with a group on a big screen. But we went with Netflix because it's 190 countries, literally, overnight. I mean, it's a different world.
You don't have to explain Netflix.
Yeah, I guess.
You don't have to explain.
But the idea that people can go all over the world and have this information available to transform them is pretty exciting.
I have a question about the woman, Dawn, from Children. That one seemed to get to you more than the other ones. Again, I only saw a little bit.
Yeah, the level of injustice to her was unbelievable.
But it seemed like you related to her on some level because you were being interviewed after and kind of going over your own history. Yeah. It was moving to watch because usually you don't see. I like seeing that side of somebody who's giving, whether you want to call it advice or whatever, because it's like, oh, all right, this is a flawed person, and this is kind of where this, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, the suffering I've gone through in my life is different than hers, but I know what it feels like to have that level of injustice, and it's why I'm so driven to find answers. And I've been doing it for 39 years, so I could be an idiot at this point and have to see there's patterns in everything.
Yeah.
Patterns that, again, make you crazy or make you happy, and once you know what they are, you can help just about anybody.
How'd you break through with your mom? How'd you finally break that?
I grew up and I got away. That's really, really what it was.
But she really tried everything to make sure that wouldn't happen, including making sure you didn't go to college, or she was trying to make sure you didn't go to college.
She tried all of the above.
But what was the narcissistic moment? Pardon me? Would you say narcissistic mom?
No, just injured mom. You know, my mom was 5'1". I'm 6'7". Give you an idea how she gave birth to me is mind-boggling. She
never got over your head.
Size O cup breasts and a size 0 pant.
What?
And I know
O cup breasts.
Yeah, I used to go buy them on my bike. I used to go buy these inserts for bras, and they would be like a beanie on my entire head. And so she was. She loved the attention she got partying or dancing, but she would never go to the grocery store. I did that every day of my life. I went on my bicycle, did the grocery store, made the meal. She never came out of this room. We lived in a 1,200 square foot house, and my forefathers all lived in the living room at different times. She was a very powerful and intense lady. But, you know, again, I'm not saying this to be positive. It's just really true. everything in my life has come from all those things that are there, all the drives. You know, now I could have just beat myself up or felt sorry for myself, but fortunately I didn't do that, you know, and it led to something that I'm really pleased with.
Who do you talk to when you're feeling shitty? Because if you're known for being a positive guy and everybody probably kind of ghosts you, hoping you fix them. So what do you do when you're like, just want to hang out with somebody and they're just trying to pick your brain to fix their own life? It's got to be irritating.
It's not irritating because it's my life, right? So you can't complain about what is a gift in your life. But for me, you know, people, the most common question I get, don't you have bad days? Don't you get screwed up? Don't you wake up in the morning and just watch porn and stuff? I said, I do some of those things, right?
What kind of porn do you watch? Yeah, let's get
now we're talking.
Set you guys up. But the truth
amateurs,
of the matter is,
right? You gotta go amateurs.
It's that the habit is all right. It's the habit of just ending the pain as it shows up, right? The anger, the frustration. It's a habit. It's all it is for people. And so it's not like I'm perfect, but I have a 90-second rule with my family. Something happens and we get stressed or pissed off. My goal is to figure out how to utilize it. And if you can't utilize it, then you just got to let it go. I mean, there's just shit that something in life you can't control. You got to let it go and move on.
Right.
And most of us are not good at letting go. And especially if you're an achiever, you always want to break through. And some things, the more energy you give it, the harder it is to solve. You know, like problems need energy to live. Sometimes just letting it go lets it just dissipate. And so I've learned to do that. And I can't help other people unless I can do it with myself, right?
But is that also suppressing the problem?
No. Suppressing is we try to pretend it's not there or fake you're not feeling anything. This is about being authentic and just reminding yourself that in any moment, what's wrong is always available. So is what's right. And it's all a matter of what you decide to focus on. And so, you know, you could sit here right now and, you know, some people, they think about shit that hasn't even happened and feel bad about it in advance, right? Yeah. You know, and if their life is good, they think of all the people in the world in terrible shape and feel like shit. Well, you're feeling like shit doesn't help you with somebody else. My whole thing is, you know, if you get on a airplane, the first thing they say is, you know, if we have a problem, the mask comes down, put on yourself first, then your kid. Because if you don't put it on yourself, you can't help anybody else, right? You're not going to function. And it's the same thing with our society. Most of us are trying to work on our kids or our husbands or our wives or, you know, our bosses, but we don't work on ourselves.
Yeah.
And we're going to ourselves first. You can impact all those people because you're coming from a different place. You're not coming from a weak place. You're not coming from a broken place. You're coming from a place where you're whole.
Let me ask you this. You're an extremely positive person. We all know that. What's your thoughts on the extreme negativity on social media? What is all that about? I mean, so many people just lashing out to complete strangers.
Yeah.
What is, I'm trying to understand that. And everyone that has a social media account has to deal with this shit. Yeah. What is going on there?
Well, think about it. There are different, everything people do, they have reasons for. Somebody tries to commit suicide, somebody who gives up their life for a stranger. Those are extremes. They both have reasons. There's only six real reasons I found dealing with human beings around the world. There's six needs we have. We have a need for certainty. That we can avoid pain, that we can be comfortable, that we can have some pleasure. We have a need for variety, because if you're totally certain, you're bored, right? And if there's tons of variety, you freak out. There's a balance. We have a need to feel significant, like we're unique or special, important. Everybody needs to feel that. Some people do it through money, some do it through earrings and locations nobody wants to know. Everybody's got different ways of doing it, you know? Another need is the need for connection and love. Another one is growth. Another one is contribution. So these six needs drive people. And what I look for is, what's the driving force? What's the top two? Because if your number one need is certainty, you're going this direction. If your number one need is uncertainty, you're going the opposite direction. And direction leads to destination or destiny. If I see what direction you're going, we can predict where you're going to end up. So we live in a society where the two top needs in the majority of Americans is either certainty or significance. And why that's important is they're both valuable needs, but it's kind of like, if you know somebody's phone number and you dial it in the wrong order, right number, wrong order, you're not going to reach them. Same thing with a vault. When significance or certainty lead, when certainty leads, you have to control everything, and life is always changing, and so you're freaking out all the time, or you're lying to yourself to try and pretend life is not changing. If significance is driving you, you're always comparing yourself to other people, which you have to lie to yourself and tell yourself you're better than everyone else, or you feel inferior, which then makes people overreact. So we live in a society, a Facebook society, where everything's about significance now, where people frame their life as this incredible situation, and other people feel depressed seeing this fake life someone else is projected. You know, they don't send real pictures, they filter it, they change it, they do all those things. So in the world we're in today, how do you get significance? You either take risks, take challenges and try to achieve something, which you could fail and then you feel like you're worthless and unloved, or you can tear someone else down. You can build the tallest building or you can blow up a building. It took, what, 13 years to build the tower again, and it took, what, 2 hours to burn it down, right? So when people are in media now, social media, there's no consequence. If you came to me and say, F you, you know, I don't give a shit. When I was 5'1", I would still
curse you. We curse here. He curses at his seminars, but he won't curse on the radio.
He saves it for the film.
Yes.
Okay. You're right. There's a consequence.
Yeah, but there's a consequence, right? You got to face somebody. And yes. On social media, there's no consequence. So the fastest way for me to get significance without a risk is I have the illusion I'm moving up if I can move you down. And so that's what we live in today. We live in a society where there are people, their entire focus is, I don't have any consequences. I go online and try to make myself feel good by tearing somebody else down. And if someone's successful, then they must be lucky, or they're an asshole, or they're manipulating, or they're fake, or whatever it is. Because otherwise, I have to look at me and make a comparison and say, why is my life not where I want it to be? That's a little scary. What's a lot easier is to go, you're an asshole. Right?
Right.
So that's what you see in social media. It's not going to change as long as there's no consequences.
Right.
So that's how it works.
Do you block people on social media?
I never block them. I never do. You know why? It's like all it does is flame them up more. I let all the people that know who I am just beat the hell out of them. You know, yeah. People know who you are, and that's a good thing about social media. While there's jerks out there, there's a lot more people that know what's really real, and they handle those people for you.
You're trying to bring positivity into the world, and people still go after you. That's crazy. Well,
that's part of the
That's nuts. You're really trying to get some things done and change people's lives.
Well, most people don't believe. Most people think it's all bullshit, right? Think about it. Even reality television is bullshit. So today, what's real and raw is so rare. But that's why it's so compelling. While people be in a room for 6 days like that from 71 countries, is because they don't experience that kind of realness and rawness, and that frees people.
Right.
Because when you're busy trying to manufacture an identity for yourself, you can't have it. You can't ever enjoy your life because you're not being yourself.
Yeah.
You're trying to be something you think other people are pleased by.
And you said something else in there where, take chances, go out and try to make something of yourself.
Yeah.
Now, we live in a society where everyone gets a trophy, so...
I know, it makes me crazy.
Thank you.
Failure is such an important thing.
Of course
Teaching
it is.
Teaching everybody that you're equal because you just showed up.
Of course.
Like, you wonder why millennials are like, so many people like Bernie Sanders, it's like socialism. They have no idea what socialism is. They've never been through the Soviet Union. I went to the Soviet Union when it was the Soviet Union. I sat there and watched people in line around the block trying to get bread, and then I went on a train where it was supposed to be equal, and we were all having caviar because I was a guest of the government there. And it's like, there's no equality in that situation. There's just abuse.
You think that's just laziness? I mean, as a parent...
No, it's just people don't know. This generation doesn't even know what socialism is.
Oh, God. Because, as a parent, of course you don't want to see your kid sad or devastated by
But you know what
something.
The research shows now? All the research shows now, there's a woman named Dweck at Stanford. She's done this amazing amount of research. So the worst thing you can do is tell your kid all the time how great they are. Because what happens is they start to believe the bullshit you tell them, that they're so perfect and they're so beautiful and they're so this and they're so talented. And then they run into a situation later in life when they're not talented enough and they don't know what to do because I'm supposed to be this talented person. I must be a fake. So they avoid the very thing that would make them grow versus not saying you're beautiful, honey, you're brilliant. You reward your child for effort. Your world is your child by saying, listen, this is hard as hell, and you did it. That's amazing. Because effort, consistent effort is how you can master any damn thing in your life. But if I'm supposed to already be brilliant, and I'm not showing up, boy, I don't want to see that. That's going to destruct my life. I was talking to a reporter yesterday, I won't mention who, but she was telling me how depressed she was. And it's really simple. She was raised by her family. I just dug in for a few minutes. And her parents loved her so much, told her she was so perfect, so everything. So she goes to college, and this guy, or high school first and then college, and she obsesses about a guy, and he doesn't want her. And she goes, how could he not want me? I have my family. I'm the greatest thing that ever existed. And so she goes into pure depression because she's emotionally unfit.
Right.
Right? Most of us are not psychologically strong because we live in a world where we expect, oh, I can just click on and get what I want instantaneously, and oh shit, I can steal whatever I want. It's not stealing. I'm liberating music. I'm liberating movies, right? We live in a society that's different. So we're going through a phase right now, just like Black Lives Matter and the situation you see there. I mean, what's really going on? If 98 planes land perfectly and two don't, no one's going to talk about the 98 great policemen.
Of course.
They're going to walk about, everyone's going to be obsessed about the two where everybody died. And in the African-American community, there have been police officers that have been wrongly accused, but there have been police officers that unfortunately are rightly accused and were wrong. And that happens for so many decades that there's an anger there, because under the anger is hurt and fear. I mean, the call for Black Lives Matter is not white people's lives don't matter. It's to say that these people are desperate for respect and to know that their family be protected. Who here, regardless of color, doesn't want their kid to be safe from everyone, especially the police, right? So we're at a tipping point in our society, and here's what I think is great about that. When you hit a threshold, then change becomes a must. Until it's a must, most people won't do it, because we stay with our status quo. But when it's bad enough, people finally say, we got to do something. And I think we're entering that place right now in our society.
It just drives me nuts when all the policemen are painted as bad.
Oh, I think that's insane.
That drives me insane. I understand there's an issue, and there's certainly some bad cops out there, and they got to figure this out. But when they start painting every cop as bad, it's like, no, man.
And it just gives an excuse for crazies like the guy in Dallas to do what he does, right? They use that as an excuse. No, I'm completely against that. I think our police officers are put in a totally untenable position in our society today, and it have to be understood, but both sides have to hear it. We got to bring the moms and the children and the police officers and white and black and bring them together and have those real conversations that can lead to a different level of understanding.
Is it crazy to think that you could support both Black Lives Matter and cops?
No, I do.
Okay.
I do. I think it's absurd not think that. And I don't like everything Black Lives Matter does because it's a movement made of all kinds of people, right? It's not one person, so you're going to have people abusing it, people that are going to... But I understand why somebody's standing the street when they feel like their own children are not safe. I can see why they want to disrupt things. They want to disrupt society because they want to say, pay attention to me. Because it's easy for a white person. White people are, I don't think they're uncaring. They just don't have the experience. Any one of us being pulled over, we're pretty confident we've done nothing wrong, nothing's going to happen. If you're African-American, that just isn't true, unfortunately.
Well, they had a parent on TV. I was half watching. I want to maybe find more on this, but they have a black kid and a white kid, and they said when the white kid goes out at night, I have no doubt he's coming home.
Yeah.
And in the back of my mind, every time the black kid goes out, I worry if he's going to come home safely. Yeah. And that's a parent talking.
No, my parents were always bummed out when they heard the front door opening.
Wow, you got a big fucking mitt. He just gave Jimmy a fist bump. That's a big fist.
Hand. Oh my goodness. Wowee.
What else did I...
I wanted to ask you a question about anger. For me, anger is the hardest one. Like it's such an addicting thing, being mad. It's like...
Do you know why?
Physically, I don't know why.
Because it meets one of the things that I found, these six needs I told you about: certainty, uncertainty, significance, love, growth, contribution. Anytime your brain links up that doing something, believing something, or feeling something matches at least three of those needs, you'll become addicted to it. Whether it's a positive thing or a negative, you'll still be addicted to it. So when you're angry, how much certainty is pursing through your veins when you're totally pissed? 0 to 10.
Yeah.
It's a 10, right? When you're angry, how significant do you feel? People respond to you, even if they don't like you, because you're so damn intense, right? So you got a 10 of significance. And besides that, you got certainty and significance, but you're also connected to yourself. If somebody feels insignificant, and you go through the hood of any major community, and I come and put a gun to your head, how certain am I that you're going to respond to me right now on a 0 to 10? It's 100 on a 0 to 10. How significant am I in your life? I'm a 10, right? And in a sick way, we're connected. Because everything in your life depends on me in that moment. And it's always going to change. There's variety. So it literally, violence has been with us forever because it meets so many of our needs. And you don't have to have intelligence. You don't have to have money to use violence to get significance. And that's why it's around.
So how do you get through this?
You got to find better ways to meet people's needs. Like you don't stop doing something. You start doing something else that's more fulfilling. So if you smoke cigarettes, what needs do you meet? Certainty you can be comfortable because you're stressed out. You take that breath. You're killing yourself, but it feels good right in the moment. You know, what else do you get? You get a sense of connection with yourself. I'm giving myself a gift. You know, it used to be you were significant if you smoke because you're a hard ass. You know, you can't make me not do this. Well, met three or four needs. So if you stop smoking, most people start eating. Because eating allows them to have certainty. They're comfortable. Eating makes them feel a connection with themselves. Eating meets all those same needs. So unless you find a better way, there used to be I don't know if you're old enough to remember, there used to be a thing called the Schick Center for Stopping Smoking. I don't know if you guys remember that.
Oh, God, no.
It was in California, so maybe you didn't hear it out here. But they had this incredible track record. They get people off smoking, and they went bankrupt. And the reason they went bankrupt is, the way you got people stop smoking is they put electrodes on your face and your neck. They have you light a cigarette and they zap the shit out of you.
Oh, wow.
And it worked. But the reason they went bankrupt is people stopped smoking and they started eating and getting fat. And so they were pissed off at the system and the whole thing blew up, right? Mm-hmm. So you have to meet the needs of the old behavior in a better way. That's how you get lasting change.
So how do you get past the fact that, what Jimmy was talking about?
The anger?
Yeah. How do you get past that?
You start to feel it moving. It's that physical thing.
I used to do this all the time myself, so I can totally relate. You get... for whatever starts triggering you, once you get in that state of being angry a regular time, it's easier to get there. And after a while, you're wired to be angry. So what I do is every morning, I have a process called priming. And what I do is I realize that the two emotions that screw people up the most are anger and fear. When you're afraid, you don't do what you need to do. When you're angry, you know, it just shuts you down. And the antidote is one emotion, and that's gratitude, as corny as it sounds. Because you can't be angry and grateful simultaneously. You can't be fearful and grateful simultaneously. So I do this process where I change my body, and I just do this 10 minutes every day. I do this morning, 5 a.m. It's insane, but it's only 10 minutes. So my deal with myself is, if you don't have 10 minutes for yourself, you don't have a life. And I do this radical change in my body, and I take 3 minutes, and all I do is think of 3 things that I'm really grateful for. And I make one of them something simple, like my child's smile on his face, my son, let's say, our daughter, or the wind on my hair, something like that. Not just like, oh, I just made $1 billion, you know? And
did you just casually say that?
It's an exaggeration.
Okay.
But the bottom line is, what I do is I see it, I feel it, I bring it in my body. So it's like, remember I said most people are, you know, wired for frustration or anger, and they got a dirt road to happiness. I wire myself to gratitude, and I'm, by not going into the anger so much, it becomes a dirt road to happiness. So you got to like break the pattern. If you don't use it, you lose it. That's true of good things. Like, if you don't, faith unused doesn't grow, it shrinks. Passion unexpressed gets less. Anger unexpressed will weaken, but you need an alternative, and you need to wire yourself. And it would probably take you 10 minutes a day if you really wanted to. But my bet is you kind of want to and you kind of don't, because the anger also gives you a sense of power, a sense of significance, a sense of certainty. You may not like the impact, but you like other aspects of it. That's why
it's
when people don't change, it's because it meets some of their needs, but not all.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like when you're split. If it's really bad, you just stop. If it's really good, you keep doing it. It's that mixed emotion that keeps people from
changing. See, I always felt like if I got rid of my anger, it would affect my stand-up, because that's where most of my jokes come from being angry. And if I lost that, then I would have nothing to write about.
Well, it's interesting. Something you might want to consider, I don't know if it's true or not, but it's worth you considering, because I did this with myself. Anger would drove me in the beginning. You can only imagine. Like, I'm going to show my mom, and no one's going to do this to me again. I'm not going to let anybody be done like this. That was my initial. But today, I have 100 million times more resources. I do more with my pinky than it used to take 24 hours a day. And so today, it's not anger-driven, and I don't need the anger. But I used to believe I would lose my power, like Samson getting his haircut, you know? And what I found, I bet the same is true with you, my friend, is my bet is you don't have to have the anger. You can still use the anger. But I bet you have so much talent, skill, and history now that it's really, that's just where your origins are. So you, it's like an athlete. You know, they wear the same jock strap, you know, because they won, you know, 5 games in a row. They keep on wearing the same thing. It's like, we want to keep doing things, but it's really a myth. It's where you started. It's not who you are today. And I don't know that for sure about you, but it would be an educated guess based on my history that belief system will make you have to become engaged and have the suffering of anger, because there's suffering. Anytime you're not in a beautiful state, whether it's generous or creative or driven or hungry or playful or fun or crazy or grateful, the only other states you can be are suffering states, and anger is a suffering state. Because you're not angry because your life is beautiful, right? You're angry because there's something that's not right. So I still see injustice, but I don't have the anger about it. I just have a beautiful state about it, because I just go, you know what? This is part of the process. My being angry is not going to change it. My being angry constricts everything in my body. And by the way, if you're angry just for 5 minutes, it takes 4 to 5 hours for that to get out of your biochemistry. That's the stacking effect that anger has in the body. It constricts the blood vessels. I mean, what it does to your body is pretty brutal. So I believe anger is a useful thing to use at times. But when we overuse any muscle, we get out of balance. You know, if you build a really strong bicep, then all of a sudden your neck hurts, your back hurts, lower back, right? Because you're out of balance. And anger overused is out of balance. And I know, because I used to use it all the damn time.
So it takes 5 hours to go away physically?
4 to 5 hours.
Wow.
Before your entire biochemistry drops back.
So if you're pissed off right now, maybe around afternoon, you're finally going to start feeling better.
Not for 30 seconds, but for about 4 or 5 minutes.
Sure.
It'll stay with you for 4 or 5 hours.
Isn't that unbelievable?
But you know what's really cool? The opposite is also true, I discovered. If you will stack great experiences, like, you don't look like, I had a guy that screwed me over in a business deal, and it was, you know, I was partners in the business. He uninvited me in my own event, and there was 10,000 people there, and then told me not to come. Lawyers told me not to come. Okay, I'm going to sue him and go through this process. Then he didn't tell anybody I wasn't coming. So 10,000 people came to see me and 5 other speakers, but I was the main pull. And when I didn't show up, he told the media I just didn't show up when he uninvited
Jesus.
Me. So you can only imagine the rage
of course.
That I had, right? And it's my identity. My brand is how I'm able to reach people, right? So I'm so angry. I'm so pissed off, and I got to go make this change. But it's like the 5th thing he's done, and that's when your brain gets hijacked. It's like when it happens once, and it happens again and again, right? And then all of a sudden, that anger is just out of control. And what I did is a little experiment with myself. I said, I got to get out of this state because it's not serving me, and I got to serve other people. How am I going to do this? I have a lot of ways to do it, but I thought, you know, how did I get in this state? I kept stacking all the things that, you know, when you get angry, you remember everything a person's ever done to screw you over.
You throw the whole kitchen sink.
Everything goes there.
That's ridiculous.
So I said, what I got to do is the opposite. I can't find that many good things with him because he's not a good guy. But let me think of anything in my life that has been magnificent, that's been sexy, that's been beautiful, that's been sacred. And what I did is just start bringing in memories random memories when I felt proud. I didn't first think of working with President Clinton. You know, I first thought of being one of the 10 Lords of Leaping in the first grade play. Shit like that pops in your head. And it's humorous, but I just kept thinking one after another for like 4 or 5 minutes. And then what happens is you end up feeling effing unbelievably passionate and alive for 4 or 5 hours, because the same thing happens if you stack good experiences, and it can be random.
Right.
It's not like an affirmation or some bullshit positive thinking. It's something that's really in you. It's a real memory that you're reactivating. And when you reactivate it, your biochemistry changes. So it's not this mental bullshit. It's a biochemical shift.
Wow. They're saying you got to go, unfortunately. I'm Not Your Guru on Netflix. It was a terrific documentary. Why did you name it I'm Not Your Guru?
I didn't name it. He did. But he pulls it from the seminar where I tell people, I'm not here to be your guru. I'm not here to be your solution. I'm here to help you find answers. I'm no better than anybody else. I'm just a coach. I'm not in the forest, so I can see what's going on.
You consider yourself a coach, because you say you don't want to be called a guru or a self. So yeah. No, yourself a coach.
I created the coaching industry 35 years ago because I wasn't a motivator, I wasn't a guru. And when I was an athlete, my coaches weren't better than I was, but they helped me because I'm in the game. I'm in the middle of it. They could see what I couldn't see, and that's really how I perceive myself. And then I was doing that. I said I was a coach for like 15 years, and I was on Larry King. I'll never forget, after I coached President Clinton. He's like, what do you mean you're a coach? You don't coach athletes. I said, I actually do. But I said, I was about to give it up. I was like, and like within 6 months, everybody was a coach. The whole culture, like all financial guys started to become financial coaches, and therapists were coaches. But what I was doing was based on results, meaning you only paid me if I produced the result. Now you go to some class, somebody wrote some course, you get a shingle, the hang up and say you're a coach, and you haven't ever produced the damn result.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a bastardized child for me, that industry that I helped
create. I have one more question before you. You walk into a guy like Clinton or whoever, someone like that who's charismatic and powerful. How do you all of a sudden convince that person, I'm the guy that you should be listening to? Like, how do you all of a sudden put yourself in a position, even if they've asked you to be there, of where I have something you need, where I can help you get something?
In the first few minutes, I find something about them where I can read something for them where they know I know everything about them. And it's not because I'm so smart, just like you guys know your business. I've done this for 39 years. There's very little that I'm not going to see or know, because there aren't that many patterns. We're all unique human beings, but there's only so many patterns, and I know what they are. So when I can slice into you and have you go, holy F, he really knows that, or I never even saw that, or that's mind-boggling, that builds instant rapport and respect. And then I really care, and people can feel that I really care. That isn't bullshit. I'm not there to like live off them or make use of their name or some bullshit like that, like so many people do. And I also don't talk about anything I do with any of the people I work with unless they talk publicly. So Clinton's talked about this. It's the only reason I bring it up. I won't do that with anybody unless they bring it up publicly.
The short answer is you smell bullshit.
Yeah.
better than almost anyone.
And most
living.
People do too, right? Yeah. So when you're real, they feel it.
For the people that enjoy the interview with Tony Robbins, you've written a lot of books. Which is the one book people could, if they've never read your
book
stuff?
I'm really proud of, it's called Money Master the Game.
Because, yeah, but you came in here and promoted it.
Yeah, you guys had me on. It was awesome. But if you get that book, I interviewed 50 of the smartest financial people in the world, Warren Buffett, Carl Icahn, and I found the common patterns and 7 things they do, and it's been mind-boggling to see the impact. It's the number one financial book of the century, of this century, new century. It's only 16 years, but it's kind of cool. And I fed up 100 million people, as I said, with it. I took a $5 million advance, and then I added money to it, and I'm doing it again this year. I'm feeding another 100 million this year. I'm going to feed 1 billion people over the next 9 years.
Wow.
I want to ask one more question. What is your stance on prescription medication? Someone's having problems. Do you encourage them to get off of it, or?
I encourage them to work with their doctor to get off it, because I'll give you an example. I'm in a room of 10,000 people. I always ask this question. How many of you know somebody who's taking antidepressants and they're still depressed? And 95% of the room raises their hand. And it's because, and if you read the side of it, it gets suicidal thoughts for someone under 24. Oh, at 25, suddenly you don't have suicidal thoughts. What kind of bullshit is this, right? So no, I get people off of it by dealing with the real cause. And the real cause has to do with the meanings you're making. I mean, think of it this way, and I'll finish with this because I know you guys got to go, and I do too. There's 3 decisions you're making every moment of your life. You're making it right now. Everyone's listening is making these 3 decisions. You might be making them unconsciously, so then your life is driven by the environment. First decision is, what are you going to focus on? Are you going to focus on what you have or what's missing? Are you going to focus on what you control or what you can't control? Are you going to focus more on the past, the present, or the future? Those 3 patterns alone, and there's dozens more. I know so much about you. For example, if you asked yourself, where do I spend more time? Everyone listening. Focusing on what I have or what's missing, what would you say?
What's missing?
What would you say?
What's missing?
What would you say?
What's missing?
Great. And if you're focused on what's missing, that can make you grow. But if that's what you focus on continuously and you add one more pattern, it'll create frustration, anger, sadness, or even depression. And the second pattern is, which one of these do you more? Do you focus more on what you can control or can't control, truthfully?
What I can't control.
Well, I can control, but I just want to be different than him.
I'd go with can't control.
Can't control. So when you focus, if you go in a pattern of focusing on what you can't control and what's missing, the stress inside of you is always going to be there. Because think about it. There's plenty of things that aren't missing, and there's plenty of things you can't control. But when you're focused on what I can't do and what's missing for my life, there's an emptiness. Now, here's the third one. Do you tend to focus more, and we do all three, but more on the past, the present, or the future?
Past.
Yeah, the same. Past.
I used to focus on the past.
And what do you do now?
The future.
Yeah. So when you have all three of those, that's why you have the anger you have, my dear friend. And I'm not being overly general here. Just think about this. If I'm constantly focused on what I'm missing, it's going to piss me off, or it's going to make me hurtful, sad or hurtful. You pick pissed off because it's more immobilizing. You're not going to sit here and just wallow in your shit. You get pissed, then you do something about it, right? Mm-hmm. But there's other ways to do it besides getting pissed. It's just the habit that you've got. And the habit comes because you see what's missing. You see you're not in control, and you're focused on the past, which you can't change. When you do those three patterns, it's going to make you stressed. Now, you don't do it every moment of your life, but when you're stressed, I guarantee those three patterns are showing. If you're focused on what I can control, what I already have that's beautiful in my life, and what's happening right now that's beautiful, or what I'm going to create, you're not going to have that level of stress. You'll still have problems, but you're not going to have the anger or the sadness or the overwhelm. Now, what's beautiful is you've converted your pain into comedy. All three of you have. You know, you've been really, first of all, I want to thank you for being serious with me on this. I expected just to
dick jokes.
Yes, I just nothing but dick jokes here last time. And I had a good time with it, but this is a really important subject. So thank you it's really kind of you guys to do this.
No, none of us are just funny enough to say anything.
Yeah, I know. It's too early.
But what I'm saying to you is you've done something most people don't do, all three of you, but you specifically, because you've described it. You've taken your pain and turned it into a gift to give other people. I've done the same thing, just in a different way, a different vehicle. But as you now enter, what, how old are you now, may I ask?
51.
So as you enter this next decade of your life,
got a pad
the
that
friction
shit.
Of the anger, the friction of the frustration, you don't need that shit anymore, right? You could free yourself up. And all you'd have to do is change the pattern and start to, and that's what I do every morning. What, instead of what's missing, what do I have? What's grateful? What's beautiful? It's easy to build on success. It's hard to build on failure. I don't care how much money you have, how much respect you have, how much love you have. Look at Robin Williams. If you don't consciously own what's really great, what's wrong, what's missing, what you can't control is all around us. And the world's constantly telling us what we can't control. And that's why people are so pissed off and frustrated. But there are things you can control. Right, that's what we focus on.
Okay. Bravo. With that, Tony.
Thanks,
beautiful.
Documentary.
I enjoyed the time.
It's I Am Not Your Guru. It's on Netflix this Friday, and it's in LA and New York in theaters this week.
That's yeah,
right. Really good, man.
I really enjoyed it. Watch on Netflix. Thank you for having me on.
All right, Tony. Thanks. Robbins. We're going to take a quick break. Stay there. Oh, we're back with Jim Florentine, Theo Von outside the studio. I want to thank Tony Robbins once again for stopping by.
He's very good.
I liked him a lot.
Yeah.
I liked that he acknowledged and realized that Jim Florentine is broken. He looked right at you.
I know. When you bypass Jim Norton as a broken man and go right to yourself, then I'm like, man, I got fucking issues.
You got some shit to take care of. Yes. Right at you as the one broken in this room.
I love it. The history in this room between you two being broken, and I get the brunt of it.
Oh, me and Jimmy pretty much skated. He focused right on you. Yeah. And your brokenness. Oh, God. That was fun. It was different. It was different radio, but it was fun.
He's
man.
Very easy. It's weird. Like, you know, his comics were very cynical people. Like you want to just be like, because I used to watch Tony Robbins. I didn't like him at all. I was like, oh, douche. But then when you interview him, it's like he's a charismatic guy. And then it's like, you listen to what he's saying. It's like, all right, none of it's stupid.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, yeah, think of good things if you're thinking of shitty things. It's kind of common sense. But
why didn't you like him at first?
Because, you know, again, being cynical is just kind of the way my brain is wired.
See.
So you'd watch him on late night TV.
Yeah.
And you'd see this guy going, personal power.
All like, right. Ugh. Okay.
You know, but again.
Personal power.
But, you know what I mean? It was like, I never looked like, hey, does he make any sense?
Yeah.
I never thought.
Yeah.
You know? How are you, Theo?
I'm doing great.
Sorry for the wait, man. We had double booked by. We didn't realize he was so early.
Look, I appreciate. You would have just sat there because, you know, he talks a lot. So I figured, let Theo have some breakfast and relax a little bit, and we'll get him in.
It was good, and I watched the movie last night, and I was keyed in on what was going on.
I didn't
on,
know that!
Yeah. I was taking notes.
Dude, I didn't know that. Then you should have been in here.
Okay. You guys asked some of the questions I would have asked for sure. I mean, it was cool. It was like, I was back there like, you know, maybe this dude can help me out a little bit. You know, I was in the other room.
You think you're more broken than I am?
I don't know that. I think, I mean, you definitely, out of the gate seem like definitely the most broken, but
Jim Norton. Yeah. You're talking about Jim Norton.
Yeah, yeah. Right. You seem like you're just kind of milling around like the broken puddle, like which is Jimmy.
No, he's the one. People like Florentine, you got worried about. He's the one. You're like, all right, what's really going on with this guy?
The cutter.
Yeah. Are you a cutter?
No.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Gassers. That's about it. Yeah. That's like a fucking maniac. I should have been dead 20 years ago.
We're gonna enjoy the fact that Robin's focused on you. That's gonna make me happy all day.
Of course.
Laser focus right to you.
Yeah, he knows
what's really going on with that guy.
You can make a lot of money off of me.
Yeah.
That moment was very intense, by the way, right? When he's fucking talking about to that children of God woman or whatever. That was like, ugh. That was really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
In a good way, though.
His childhood didn't sound that crazy to me, to be honest with you. I'm like, I don't know if I think he has it in him to be what he is anyway. I don't know if he needed, you know, his mother gave him some bad porridge or something, it sounded like.
And drinking liquid soap is kind of rough.
Yeah, but how much? I mean, that doesn't sound that crazy to me.
What? What's wrong with you?
A little bit of liquid soap?
So she could keep the son, you know, in the house?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't do that to my child. I would not do that to my child. I'm just going to lay that out there. But I don't think that, I don't know. I just think it seemed like there's been tougher stuff. But hey, it made him. I think it's dope. I mean.
You had an older father.
Yeah, I mean, my dad was real old.
Like how old again?
70. My dad was 70 when I was born.
Who's 70?
Yeah. Isn't that amazing?
Oh, shit.
Mom used to be like, get in the other room. He's going to die. So we'd go in there, and literally, he'd just be resting. We wouldn't have anything. We'd just, like, hold our hands over him like he was a fire and just stand there, like, just doing nothing. Sometimes he would pretend he was dead to kind of play with us, I think, to interact.
That's fucked up.
That was messed up.
How old was he when he passed away?
86.
So you had him to your 16.
Yeah. And you used to drive him around. I saw your special.
Yeah, I used to drive him around. I used to cruise around. He'd, you know, I kind of got him out of, as soon as I was tall enough to drive, he'd let me drive him 70, 80 miles to work. And I'd be 12 years old on the interstate.
You were driving?
Yeah, 13 at the youngest, or at the oldest, and just cruising, dude. My dad fast asleep, pick up a couple of buddies. He wouldn't even fucking know. Sorry, he wouldn't even know.
12 years old, you're on the highway?
Yeah, cruising, dude.
70 or 80 miles?
Yeah. Dude, I remember dropping him at the post office once, and he's like, I don't know if there's anywhere to park or know how to park. And he's like, well, just go around the block. And I hit about 5 or 6 cars just going around this city block. But in New Orleans, that's...
No one would notice the damage to their cars.
No, they blame it.
And your mom didn't care that you were driving at 12, 70, 80 miles with your dad.
No, they were separated at that point. They didn't really...
Okay.
It wasn't that much.
So who were you living with?
Ended up living with friends. I live with my mom and I live with friends. At 14.
At 14.
I got emancipated at 14. Just family stuff was weird, but the dad old stuff was the thing that kind of, I think.
Wait, you broke free of your parents at 14?
Yeah.
You had to do the whole go to court thing?
Yeah.
Oh, that means what was going on with your mom? I would understand older father, but how did they see it your way?
I don't know. She was just a mom.
You talk about it?
Yeah, I mean, well, she was just like...
How old was your mom when you were born?
32.
So your dad was 70 and she was 32.
Yeah. And he didn't have any money. That's the weird thing to me. Like, I can understand banging an old dude for
sugar daddy
stuff. A little bit of loot or something, a nice vehicle.
Sure.
But yeah, for some free old dude, like some...
He must have been all cock.
Yeah.
I don't know. Your dad must have had a fucking big dick.
He might have. I think I might have seen him once. I don't remember that much, though. I might have seen some of it.
Did your mom have issues?
I'm sure she probably did. I think her dad mistreated her.
You know, for you to be able to leave your parents at 14.
Yeah.
Usually that means there was some stuff going on.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I guess I don't know, man. We just didn't.
Do you see her now?
Yeah, we talk a lot now. I see her. She's just kind of a strange lady. She's not bad. She's a hard worker. She had 4 kids. And that was that, you know?
She had 4 with your...
Same dad,
dad, okay.
Who are you in the...
Number 2. I got an older brother, 2 younger sisters.
How much younger are the sisters?
2 and 4 years younger than me. So
he was still having kids at 74, even.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was up there slanging.
74.
God bless your father. That's pretty amazing.
And this is before Viagra and Cialis and stuff, so
yeah,
he was getting a
freelance.
Rod.
Yeah. Right. He was working freelance. Remember that? Well, it was interesting to me that Tony Robbins said was about how everybody's on antidepressants but still depressed. That's what hit me. I was like, dang, that's so true. Like, you're on antidepressants but still depressed. Like, that's so bizarre.
Mm.
That's where we all are.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I'm sorry we didn't have you in. I didn't know you saw the movie.
Man, look.
I thought you... man, that sucks. I wish you would have told me that part.
I was totally enjoying listening, 100%.
Right.
I mean, just 3 of you guys, you know, y'all are fielding... I mean, all, especially being comedians, all have your own issues and stuff, I'm sure.
Why does every comedian seem to have an issue? Is there one of you guys that doesn't?
None that I've met.
He would know better than anybody.
But doesn't everyone have issues?
I don't know. He's got
Rich Voss
tatted up short arms. Yeah, you don't tat short arms.
No, you hide them.
Yeah.
The older, I mean, the older you get, you realize just everyone has issues, though. You think the comedians have bigger issues than the average person?
I think good comedians do.
Really have some dark shit.
We're just talking about them, I think. You know, comics are more likely to bring stuff into the light, but I don't think it's stuff that nobody else has. That's why people relate to it.
Yeah.
They're hearing stuff that they deal with, like, oh, yeah, that's how you put that into words, or that's right. What I've been thinking. It's nothing unique.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm starting to think it's not unique.
Yeah.
It's just how you guys handle it and get it out. And
a lot of us
person maybe don't have that outlet or don't have the skills to do that.
Right.
A lot of us are socially awkward, too, so we were the quiet ones just observing instead of participating. So we're just, you know, just watching.
Right.
Cutting our own hair. Remember that?
I do that now, but yeah, I do.
I know you cut your own hair, don't you?
No.
You used what to are you saying?
Florentine.
I pay $30 for this.
No, you don't, bro.
Yeah, I do. With a fucking $20 tip, I'm trying to bang her.
This is going
to
be my favorite. This is going to be my favorite Florentine.
Theo was appalled.
No, man. You should just cut it yourself, I think.
I'm a grown man. I don't use gel on my hair, you know.
Between Tony Robbins.
I don't think you need gel. But I think you could cut it yourself and you. And say that money.
Oh, God. Man. This is going to be
you cut yours yourself?
Yeah.
Do you really?
Yeah. The back, I got to get this gal to cut it, but.
You really cut your own hair?
Yeah. And I'm good at it, man.
Why are you cutting your own hair?
That's what I'm saying. If you could cut your own. You know what, dude? I'll email you some stuff. There's like a.
Don't say the Flo-bee.
No. You just get a hanger after a while. It's my own hair.
You're
36 years old.
Hanger. Oh, a hanger. I think you said a hanger.
No.
I'm like, this is what my father wanted to do 47 years ago.
But what? I mean, you're doing well for yourself. Why won't you just go and get a haircut?
Yeah, well, at this point, I got it down. You know? I'm like, I mean, if it's something that's really important, I'll go out there and
I've tried
somebody.
To cut some things off just because I don't
bangs,
have time
maybe.
Or whatever.
Yeah, the bangs. But, you got bangs.
Oh, if it's a little hanging a little low, yeah. You cut him, yeah.
Like a milkmaid.
I'm going today to get a cut. Jesus. I'm paying.
He's going to cut his bangs. What's
wrong
with
paying?
Having...
Oh, sorry, big shot.
What's wrong with having bangs?
No, I don't know. I don't want bangs.
So
bangs.
You got to carry scissors around with you on the road, basically.
Like, just don't run with them. We're getting aside. Yeah.
But let me ask you this. I can't figure it out because when you're looking in the mirror with the scissors, it gets all fucked up, right?
Dude, yeah. I can't so get my eyebrows without that? Getting
exactly.
I literally, when I'm getting my eyebrows, I have to do it by feel. My eyebrows I have to cut my eyebrows. They get crazy.
Now, that's insane.
What? Have you seen his eyebrows?
I have to.
I cut my eyebrows. Oh, you're not old enough. It'll happen.
Oh, yeah. I'm not doing that.
Yeah, you got to trim them a little.
That,
yeah.
That first time when you're sitting there and you get your haircut done, and then the woman looks at your eyes and snips for the first time, you're like, oh, fuck me.
Clips in here, huh?
And then you got to get them clipped every single time you get a haircut now. Yeah. Jimmy used to have one. Do you still have it?
It goes crazy. Way out? And I would leave it, and my girlfriend hated it so much. So when she wasn't looking, I would just touch her cheek with my eye. I wasn't allowed to hit her, so I'm like, I just do that to annoy her.
No exaggeration, Theo. It would pop out close to 2 inches.
Oh, that's beautiful.
He had one. I think it was on your left side. See? We all know the famous one hair that Jimmy allowed to grow straight out from his body.
You should raffle that off every year to do a fundraiser.
Cut it off, yeah. Charity. Put in a little baggie.
But your hair is good, so it's
okay.
You certainly figured it out.
We got checked out the other day.
You figured it out.
What do you mean you got it checked out?
You went to the hair guy and they give you, they evaluate you, and see where if your hair's falling out or not.
What hair guy? What do you mean?
What are you talking about? You got a full head of hair. Why would you even think
that? But what hair guy?
The hair analyst or whatever it is. Just pictures of hair. but yeah, hair analyst, man.
I don't.
If you're going to get like
plugs,
implants or something, you go to the guy and see him first, and he's like, no, you're doing okay.
What made you think that, or was it just a maintenance thing you wanted to do?
Just nervous, man. I spend most of my time going to doctor's offices and thinking something's wrong.
It's probably because you fucked up your hair cutting it. You're like, oh, shit, I'm going bald.
he's got a full head of hair.
I know, he doesn't, yeah.
I got enough. No, but it's starting to get to that point where I got to find a wife soon because you start to kind of evaluate how long your hair is going to be around. I feel like
you can still get laid bald.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now you can just cut it all off, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Florentine does well with those bangs.
Yeah, this is a beautiful look.
Yeah, see, I get a cut and I do all right.
A little Dutch lady. No, I think you have nice hair.
Thank you.
I did rate y'all whose voice sounded the sexiest, though, when you guys were in here. Florentine, you got first, man.
But I did Florentine's voice. Nah, his voice is...
Pete Robbins, by far. And I have no... You know, and I don't... And I kind of... I probably like you maybe better than Tony Robbins because I know you better, but I feel like I like Tony Robbins, so maybe y'all were equal. But you won. Robbins got second. Bonnie McFarlane on the commercial got third. Whatever commercial. Opie, you got fourth. You got.
Yeah, I don't have a very sexy voice at all.
You're rating our sexy voices?
Dude, I'm chilling in there with Roland.
He wants to cut my hair? Yeah. What the fuck's going on here?
We should have had you in. I feel like an idiot. I didn't realize you saw the movie. Hey,
I don't like that my voice, even though I know he's right, it still hurts that I came in last place.
Yeah, but I think you could have beat out some other people that are in the room that are being quiet.
Possibly. Roland's voice is an abomination.
Where's Roland's voice in that, as far as sexiness goes?
Roland's voice is it's really bad. He said something in the hallway when I walked in here, and I was like, his voice is bad.
Yeah, it's like a yammering, fucking stammering, and nothing of substance is coming out, and it's not clear.
I can't figure him out. He does his job amazingly well, and I've seen him interact with, like, really big celebrities, and they get really excited to see Roland, and they understand what he's saying, I guess.
Yeah. But they don't, but they think it's important. Because he's like,
it's like an attack lisp. It's like somebody who has a lisp, he's usually shy. He's like, just attacks you and was aggressive with it, you know?
Yeah.
And he didn't disappoint last night. He was fast asleep at Ghostbusters.
How far into the movie?
Well, I mean, he was sleeping so heavily that his weight was pushing up against me because he was sitting to my right. All of a sudden, his big legs were pushing up against mine. I knew he was out. I would say maybe 20 minutes in. I think he might have made...
he slept through the rest of the movie?
Yeah, but that doesn't mean the movie sucks. I've seen Roland sleep at these premieres. He's never stayed awake for the entire movie.
Too bad he didn't have while he was watching The Dark Knight. All right, too old a reference.
I'm trying to...
The Dark Knight is Heath Ledger died, didn't he?
No, there was just a shooting in the theater.
Jesus, of course. Sorry, fuck. Ghostbusters was all right, though.
Yeah?
Yeah, as a movie, I liked it. But as soon as you post something on Twitter or Instagram, I just posted a picture that, you know, it said Ghostbusters, the movie was about to start. Then the comments, people were like...
Were they positive comments?
God, no.
what are you going to see that for? What the fuck's wrong with you?
You better be honest about your review. All this stuff. I'm like, of course I'm going to be honest about it. As a movie, I liked it.
Yeah.
I don't get caught up in the whole fact that it's you shouldn't remake Ghostbusters. Why did you remake it with the women? Although it does go against something we have said over the years. When they remake comedies, it drives us fucking nuts. So
yeah,
I guess that's a bit hypocritical. But
well, I don't want to see women fighting ghosts. Honestly, I think it's a man's responsibility. I think there needs to be some gender roles even in movies and stuff like that. And I don't think women shouldn't be allowed to fight ghosts. That's fine. You don't like ghosts? Fight them. But I think that I'd rather see it. If there's a ghost on my property, you stay here. Honey, I'm going to go handle this.
You wouldn't send your wife out to... No. Deal with it.
Although they probably relate to the ghost because ghosts are just kind of fucking irritating. They don't stop. You deal with them. You guys relate to each other.
You go out and the wife and ghost are just chatting in the yard.
Why do you rattle the chains? Because nobody listens to me. I know he doesn't listen to me either.
I will bet the reviews will come in around 2 to 2.5 stars out of 4 for this movie.
It's at 75% right now.
75% for reviewers or
for reviewers.
Reviewers. So that would be 3 out of 4.
Yeah, but you tell people that it's good, and they're convinced that you're either getting paid by the studio.
Well, that's exactly what was popping up on my Instagram. I'm like, Jesus.
You wouldn't do that, though.
We're going to talk to the director tomorrow. No, in general, we don't. Yeah. I'm sure we're not perfect. I'm sure we've bullshitted our way through some of these things over the years. But
well, the last director I was in when y'all had was talking about, that's when y'all did the eel porn and had the dang. You guys aren't playing favorites, I don't think.
Right. Oh, that was for Batman versus Superman. Yeah. Which turned out to be a bust, right, Eric? Batman versus Superman was a bust, no?
Yeah, it was not good.
Was it bad? Not really?
Zack Snyder.
It's over 3 hours of nonsense. Mm. Could have been done in under an hour and a half.
What do you mean of nonsense? The fact that
I don't understand. I don't know where to go with this.
No, he's talking about Batman versus.
I was trying
Superman
to simplify it for you, Jim. You got the face. You got the guy who played Jesse Eisenberg playing Lex Luthor, and he was horrible. He was too whiny, emo for what the character was. Too much internal strife because of their moms was a whole underlining issue of Batman and Superman having mommy issues and. It just was. It was nonsense.
Maybe they didn't know. They didn't know what to do with it to make it feel new or fresh. Like, you know, in the '50s, when they created these things, whatever, it was just different. And he fell from space, and then there he is.
Yeah. So now they're trying to Superman.
But yeah, I'm kind of.
There's nothing you can do to help Superman.
I'm kind of fucking done with Superman too.
He was never
after the whole horse incident. I'm like, I've had enough.
Yeah. Eric, tell us about Ghostbusters, because this is more your world. You texted me after the movie, because I ran the fuck out of there. I wasn't going to listen to the Q&A. I had to go home.
Was it premiere you were at?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
I sat next to... it was just a screening, I should say. I was sitting next to Ron Bennington and his wife. Ron seemed to really enjoy the movie. His wife enjoyed it. Roland, who knows, he was sleeping. Eric texted me on the way home, said, surprisingly good movie.
The story was good.
And you liked the story.
Story was good. There's a few things here and there, little stuff that don't really make sense or add up to enjoying the movie. But the story overall was actually entertaining. I was really surprised going into this. I know Jim said I keep getting mad at the trailers, but the trailers don't accurately display what the movie is. Like Leslie Jones comes off really bad in the trailers. And I know in a lot of the reviews saying, oh, it's a stereotypical black woman being loud and obnoxious and sassy and all that stuff. And there are those moments.
In the theater?
There are those moments in the movie. But you see the rest of her character as it starts and develops in there, and it's not that at all. Mm. So the trailer's not accurately portraying her and her character as far as the movie goes. I've said that it references the original Ghostbusters at the beginning in the movie trailers and then says, yeah, that happened, but not really. We're starting all over again. So what was the point of referencing the old people? And the original Ghostbusters cast making their cameos, I'm not going to spoil it for anybody, but they're okay. They're okay. It didn't matter if they were in there or not.
Ghosts out here?
So.
Yeah, but it was fun that they popped up.
I guess.
God, did I just say it was fun?
If you were looking at that.
Why, that's a perfectly acceptable thing.
Cut your eyebrows, bro. Cut your eyebrows.
My aunt said the same thing. Oh, my God, that was so much fun when the old Ghostbusters came in. I said, I know.
I let that one slide.
Thank you, Florida.
It was fun when they popped in.
There's
a nice surprise.
I got caught up in the whole thing. Oh, Dan Aykroyd as the cabbie.
Spoiler.
Is that a spoiler?
Yeah.
Is anyone going to be mad that he's...
I don't know. Everyone's mad about the movie anyway.
No, but is anyone going to be mad that he said Dan Aykroyd's a cabbie?
Well, I was looking forward to seeing who come up where, and now all of a sudden I know I'm going to be looking out for the cabbie.
Sorry.
Some people just don't want to see the change, you know? They don't want to see the change. They don't want to see Black Annie. They didn't want to see...
Black Honeymooners.
Yeah, Black Honeymooners.
Yeah, because here's what the people don't like about the comedies. When they soften, not that the Honeymooners was edgy, but like Bad News Bears, is when they take out some of the harsher stuff
that made the movie.
That's what makes you crazy.
It drives me nuts. Yeah. With that famous scene where Walter Matthau is drinking and driving, and the kids are all drinking. That made that movie fantastic, and one of the things that made the movie so great. And then in the remake, they're drinking soda or something, and they all have their seatbelts on. I think they're in car seats at that point.
Yeah,
it's like, what are you doing?
Boyle's racist fucking chat. It was fucking hilarious in that movie.
They did it with Arthur, too, to remake Arthur.
That was good.
Yeah.
You like that?
No, I didn't.
They changed a lot of the dialogue in that, too.
He had to get sober at the end or something. I don't remember.
I want to see, like, an Asian Amistad. You know, have y'all seen that movie?
I have seen Amistad,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'd like to see a remake of that, but with Asian people.
As who, though? As the slaves or as the guys
as
on the boat?
Slaves.
Oh, okay.
Because I think the only way to beat slavery, you gotta start... doling it out to everybody,
right?
You know, you got to kind of do some remakes with
that playing field.
Yeah.
Iraq, also, I was in a cab, and Iraq goes, you went home early. There's something after the credits. I'm done with that shit.
Yes. Yeah, if you're gonna give
movies,
me
movies, Pearl Jam, why stay for the end?
Well, attaboy, Iraq, you don't take any shit.
I'm not going to sit through the credits when they change the music. There's so much credits that they go from the cool song to now it's just piano music because they don't know what else to fucking play because it just keeps going and going and going. And then finally after that, I guess there's some surprise.
To be fair, unlike most movies, when they do their big song at the end going into the credits and it's usually just a black screen with the credits going.
Yeah.
They have a lot going on in the background, little extra stuff so while the credits are going, so you still will watch.
Yeah, I sat through all that.
Leave. Do you like the bloopers? I love the bloopers. Like, did you ever see at the end of The Accused when they'll show like, when she's laying on the table and somebody's cowboy hat falls off and they all start cracking up and the crew laughs?
I miss where, like, the film would just cut off and you would just hear, like, whatever, like, seedy activities were still going on in the theater would just come to light immediately, you know?
Oh, wow. There you go. Some jerking off and whatnot.
Yeah, a little
dry humping.
Yeah, depending on the movie. You know? Yeah.
Scale of 1 to 10, what was Ghostbusters, E-Rock?
I'd give it a 7.
All right.
I was surprised.
Yeah, that's about right, all I would say. It was a good movie.
And
I enjoyed it.
Stay for the end. They kind of, the post-scene credits, without giving anything away, ties back in to a whole bunch of different stuff from the original movies.
See, E-Rock has a good way of painting the picture without giving away the spoilers.
What's her name stole the movie? The blonde...
Kate McKinnon.
Kate McKinnon stole the movie.
Best.
From SNL?
Movie. Yeah,
from SNL. Does the Hillary Clinton impression?
All the SNL people in the movie were really good. Steve Higgins, who's the who was the head writer of Saturday Night Live, is now the head writer and announcer for Jimmy Fallon.
Yes,
has a role in the movie, and he's good. All the SNL people and alumni that are in the movie are really good.
And our pal Michael K. Williams pops up.
Oh, cool!
He got a little action.
Hopefully, he's not buying a pack of Newports. That's just a stupid reference. I need a good reference. Even The Wire.
I know.
Last thing you said.
Oh, fucking
Jesus, man. That's the only Tony Robbins really hit some of you guys in the heart this morning, though. Did he kind of? I mean, were you? Is it different when you have that kind of guest come in and it's like you
it was
feel
awesome.
Like he has a power, kind of?
No, usually I'm the one who inspires.
It was nice to take a back seat.
Yeah.
And relax a little bit.
Yeah, when the inspirer is inspired.
Yeah, I want to meet the person that's been inspired by GM.
It was very different. It was a very different way to start a radio show, but it was good. I liked it.
Yeah.
Florentine was talking about his kid because we were talking about how every kid gets a trophy.
Yeah.
And he's your kid's finally in sports and he's playing T-ball.
Yeah, T-ball. There was they don't keep score. Every game ends in a tie and they all get a trophy.
Does
every, because he would ask me after every game, so did we win or lose? And like, he's like, no, it was another tie. I'm like, it was a tie.
See, I'm dealing with that same shit, but then when you talk to the parents, aren't they all pissed off? They're like, why the fuck are we doing it this way? Or are they embracing it?
They're on a fence about it. I think it's, you know, they don't say anything about it. I'm just, every game's a tie.
That's just stupid.
Is it hard?
He's even like, Dad, why are we tying every game? Isn't someone supposed to win?
Because kids want to be competitive as well.
Yeah.
Of course they do.
Is it hard when you're a parent to pretend like another person's kid is like a decent kid? Like if you see their kid and you're like, oh, this kid is a total...
What a fucking waste of cum.
Yeah. Is it hard to pretend like the kid is decent? Like, he seems like a great kid.
It's very hard.
Yeah.
You want to say a lot of things.
Yeah.
But
that's crazy.
Because in this new world, all the kids are together now, too.
Yeah.
When I was growing up, there was special sections in the school.
Yeah.
It was a hallway that you just knew wasn't for you and you didn't go down. But now they're just blending all the kids in the classroom now. So you got kids with real legitimate issues. But it's very interesting because then I think it's I'm changing, I guess.
Wow.
I think it's good.
Fun.
I think it's good.
Yeah.
What is?
You get some kids that are sort of on the spectrum, and when we were growing up, those kids would probably have a special classroom, and they're in the class.
Well, that's pretty
cool. Finding this out too, Florentine?
No, not yet.
Yeah,
no.
They had third lunch. When I was growing up, they had third lunch, and they would put the special kids. That's where the special kids would eat, and they'd come in, and they'd clean the cafeteria. I was in two. Close.
So what was two? What was the difference between
two
one
was,
and two?
You know, one was definitely the really good kids. Two was, you know, mix of kids, and three was third lunch, and then that was like the, you know, learning disabled or whatever. And then they had this one kid who was the first like white kid that wanted to be black. I don't know if we can use that term or not. I won't use it, but people always say it.
Were you a wigger?
Yeah.
What year was that?
We can say wigger.
Well, this was probably 89.
Oh, I was ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
Way before that.
Well, they had a, this was like the first wigger ever, like people had ever seen in our area. And I remember they put him in with the learning disabled kids.
Because they thought he had fucking
issues. That's hilarious.
So you'd have like kids that had like Down syndrome, and then you had this kid wearing like a Washington Redskins starter jacket, right? You know? And like dribbling like an invisible basketball. Yeah. Yeah, you did, man. He was always like posting up these like kid with a walker. He'd always like, you can't hold me in the paint. You know, he'd always just, like,
that's great.
This kid named Brian St. Pierre. Yeah, man. I don't know whatever happened to him. He had in his blood the wigginess.
So
yeah.
You wanted to check out the Third Lunch.
Oh yeah, I'd go in there sometimes and mill around. You know, this kid.
Well, that's some good watching. Some good people watching.
This was in high school?
No, this was in below high school.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, junior high, elementary, middle school. But that was it, man. That was the.
You ever hook up with any of the girls from the Third Lunch?
No, you know what I did though. One time, as I got older, I accidentally ran over this gal's dog with my car. I was late for work, and I didn't know the dog was sleeping under there. And I had to go, and I literally just yelled out the window, "It'll be okay!" Like, as I was so late for work, I did not even have time. Like, I just saw her come running out. You heard the dog bark, and then she's like crying. And then years later, I was on the beach in Gulf Shores, Alabama, and hooked up with this gal, and she goes, "Do you remember me?" And I was like, no. She's like, you killed my dog, Becky, when I was like 11 years old.
Wow. What low self-esteem does she have that she fucks you years later after you killed the dog? And you just pulled away and go, it's going to be okay. And that was it? Because you were late for work?
She needed, I don't know, man.
It's the same thing he said after he blew his load in her, too.
It'll be okay.
She needed closure.
That dog will die.
What kind of dog was it? Do you remember? Or
it was a beautiful little animal. And I didn't really like animals at the time. And I've grown more accustomed to animals now. But
well, you didn't know. You just taken off for work.
Yeah.
What kind of job was it?
Yeah, how important was your job that you couldn't stop?
Yeah, what did you do? I was a busboy at this seafood restaurant. But I was meeting one of the brothers was selling me a bag of weed before work, and I was meeting him over there.
Well, fair enough.
This big fella named Coltrane, this dude. He probably died. He was so big, you know, big people die, you know. Yeah, that's what I'm worried about Tony Robbins. He seems like a... How tall is he?
He's 6'7", he said.
Oh, Jesus.
He's a giant. His head is... I've never seen a bigger head in my life. It's unbelievable how big his head is.
And his hands.
And his hands were huge. Everything on him was huge.
But did he sit in both chairs or one chair?
One chair, and he was pounding the table, and he was teaching us about life.
Oh, I can feel it.
Who's
in there.
Who's this? Oh, it's
Tony Robbins.
Yeah, I was just thinking about his giant fucking hand. He put his mitts up, and his hands are twice the size of mine.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty close.
God.
Yeah, I say it all the time. When you walk around New York City, you never see old, tall dudes.
Yeah, it's scary.
Every once in a while, you will, and you will like stop and go, you know, you'll look at that and go, wow, that's pretty amazing.
He has like a Schwarzenegger.
And you never see very old, fat people either.
Mm-mm. He's got like an Arnold look to him.
Yeah.
Like almost in the build and how big he is and all that stuff. And
yeah.
He big kind of, shoulders and chest and stuff.
He's a giant man.
If he grew his hair out, he could play Andre the Giant, I think. Put him in an old school wrestling place.
Yeah.
Yeah, he seemed like a second, like a reboot of Andre the Giant, kind of.
Yes.
That fist would hurt crashing. And I have very delicate cheekbones, obviously, and it would hurt. I just feel a fucking fist of that size.
That Theo, I wanted to ask you something, just getting back to the thing. So she tells you, you're fucking her on the beach, and she goes, you killed my...
No, we made love inside.
Okay, but you killed my dog when I was 11 years old. What did you say to that? Do you remember? Did you apologize? Did you still get an erection?
I was explaining to her I was late for work. No, I don't think we didn't make a love. We didn't hook up again. I explained to her that I was late for work, and that was it.
Well, and she was okay with that? Like, okay.
Yeah, she was fat. I mean,
because he was being honest. We learned that from Tony Robbins. Honesty is the best policy. Yeah. So there you go.
Yeah, I mean, she was...
You're a disciple of Tony Robbins.
I'm trying to remember. She wasn't even... She was an okay-looking gal. She wasn't the cutest gal, but...
What have you been up to since we've seen you last?
Just doing a lot of shows, man. Traveling. What else?
I hear the podcast is really good.
Podcast is great,
and
man.
You get a lot of attention from your podcast.
Yeah. TMZ, we had Dr. Drew on the other day, who's really awesome. Have y'all had him in here?
No,
I love Dr. Drew. I would talk to him.
Well, he is he's an amazing person to be around, I thought. And he knows a lot of information. And you can ask him about anything. You know, I'm sick or somebody else is sick.
my bangs, you know?
You're not going to let your bangs go. Oh, they're beautiful.
I'd rather get mine fucking cut by a professional.
Wow.
That's how I feel about fucking.
Wait, there was something on TMZ about your podcast. Somebody came out.
Oh, we had Claudia Jordan was talking about Jamie Foxx was dating Tom Cruise's ex-girlfriend was on there. And then
there was somebody that said that they regretted fucking somebody.
Yeah. I don't remember who that was. It could have just been me talking on there.
No, but it was some like a Miss America. Somebody was saying that they regretted.
TMZ has picked up a few things.
Not sleeping with somebody from your podcast.
Huh. I don't know. Drew didn't say anything. Who else is coming in? Farrah Abraham. That girl's coming in.
You know, I liked her more after I met her. I didn't like her when we first interviewed her. But after the second time I had met her, I did David Tell's Comedy Underground thing with. She was there. Mm-hmm. She was actually nice.
Yeah.
She's a teen mom, right?
Yeah.
She's batshit crazy.
Yeah.
You'll have a good time with her. What are?
She does porn.
Yeah.
Is she still doing porn?
Oh, yeah.
I'm getting off of porn. What's that, man? Paul? I'm off.
She did one and done.
She had two of them.
Well, he rocks his too now. What was it? Was there one and then a sequel?
No, Eric's right. No, She's done more than one.
There was two of them. I think both with the same boyfriend. But
his name is James Dean. That guy, was that her boyfriend?
I just hated that she tried to say that it was secretly taped when it was so obvious.
That drove me nuts when she came in here.
She wouldn't let it go. I'm like, come on.
Well, that was the selling point, probably. That's probably how you get things sold.
But God. Yeah.
It's a new thing.
Yeah. It's like bringing in the Ghostbusters girls and making them tell you, like, no, the ghosts aren't real. You know, like, you know what I mean?
I heard you say that.
You're off the porn.
Yeah, I'm off, man. How long? I'm doing okay right now. I think I'm about 11 days.
Is it bad to be on porn, you think?
I've started to notice some changes in my body, even. I swear.
Was it less sticky?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Easier to read a book.
Yeah, your right hand actually can hold something else.
What do you mean changes in your body?
Just like I just feel a little bit better. I feel a little more relaxed. I feel like I could have more hope for the future, honestly.
Are you still jerking off a lot or dirty texting or no?
I'm still doing a little bit of dirty texting.
Okay, because for me, that pattern of jerking off is so hard to break.
Yes,
porn is bad, but it's not the texting is the hardest thing for me.
Really?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, and that'll happen too. You'll be off porn, but then some woman sends you something, and you're like, oh, you know, surprise porn,
and you get dragged right back in.
Yeah, so you gotta be very
careful.
How
much porn were you watching where you felt like I got to get off this?
I was just watching it in the evenings by myself.
So not a lot though.
How long though?
Probably like
probably about 15 or 16 years.
No, but how long
each time?
Probably maybe 3 minutes.
That's it.
But two and a half minutes.
That doesn't seem to be a problem.
I think it is a problem. I mean, it just felt like a problem. After a while, I just don't have any, like, feeling. Like, I just, it just happened enough where I was like, this is an issue.
If 3 minutes a night, quitting that is enough to make your life, I mean, Jesus Christ, I have some good days ahead if I stop. Holy shit.
Yeah, I don't know, man. It's tough out there.
So you would just jerk off and the 3 minutes come and that was it, shut it off.
Yeah, and then shut it down. I feel disgusted. Maybe read a chapter of like a self-help book or something like that. And then try to get it back together, pray a little bit, and then go to sleep.
What were you watching?
Pornography.
No. What kind of pornography?
Yeah,
it might have been stuff you were embarrassed about?
Yeah, I mean, stuff I probably wouldn't discuss, but nothing with, like, you know, animals or anything like that.
No, I know.
Nothing with, like, dogs getting run over?
No, nothing like that.
Tranny porn.
Yeah.
If I don't hear a beagle under a truck tire. I can't get
I'm
off
I'm going to get
anymore.
Some tranny porn, maybe.
Yeah. Uh-uh. No. Okay. Nothing with males in there.
Well, when you say I don't really want to discuss it, you better, because people are
just
are
basic stuff. You know, basic pornography. People doing sex and...
So girl on girl, guy.
Yeah, men and women. Men and women. You know, and they're brothers.
Interracial.
Black guys with their shoes on still.
Black guys with their shoes on. What is that? Is that part of the fetish?
Yeah, I mean, that's something that's going on out there.
I didn't know the shoes stayed on.
What, you got to keep the shoes on?
Black guys
on.
Keep their socks on a lot in porn. I noticed that.
Yeah, it could be socks, too. Some of it's older that I'm watching. I'm trying to... That's one thing I tried to do to get off was watch some of the older stuff that's a little more intimate, I feel like.
Oh, yeah. I get you on that.
A little storyline, maybe. A little bit more of
Or just grainier. I can't stand the definition sometimes.
All the pimples and stuff and high def.
Yeah, and you can see some of their battle wounds. You can see... either.
Yes. Yeah.
You know.
You want to be titillated a little more. A little storyline or a little something that's a little more believable.
Yeah. I just think it's a problem, man. I mean, you got to feel it.
I think he's totally right.
You got religious roots, too. So does that come into play?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I just feel like, Jesus Christ. That is pornography right there. Just popped up on that television.
That's who you're going to be interviewing.
Oh, yeah.
And she's taken pretty much her whole hand.
Yeah, that is one way to meet someone.
No, she's got four fingers in there, and the thumb's kind of tickling the thigh. Well, like, hey, how are you?
It's a fist bump.
Well, I think they're going to, you know, they can't give away the thumb. And
that's for the sequel.
Right, that's the trailer. I mean,
that's for the sequel, man.
You got to buy the movie to see the thumb going, too.
My, wow, that's crazy. I don't understand how people could do that, you know? Could you do it?
What?
Pornography.
No, I couldn't. I have a lot of respect for the performers. My dick wouldn't stay hard.
Jimmy has been on set.
I've been on the set a few times when they shot. Yeah,
and it's not sexy.
Jenna Jameson,
right?
Shoot. I watched Belladonna shoot. Yeah,
it's not sexy. I mean, they're obviously hot as fuck, but the whole thing isn't really that sexy, right?
The amateur stuff. Belladonna's was sexy because it was just her husband at the time shooting, and then her and a girl. But Jenna's was like a fucking. It was like a giant set. It was like a real set. There was craft services, costumes, like, so you didn't feel, there was no intimacy. The amateur stuff was sexier.
Yeah.
Because it was like just this guy shooting a couple. And that was kind of hot to watch because you felt like you were in spying a little bit or more intimate. But no, I watched a girl with two guys, and the guy Mark Stone, who worked, was directing it, and he was kind of helping me prepare to shoot, to film the award show. And he's going, come on, give me some more. Like, that's what these directors do. That's why you hear music. And they were on a bench. A guy's laying on his back, and a girl is straddling him. And there was another guy, like, fucking her in the ass. And the fact that these two guys could keep their dicks hard.
Yeah.
All of this distraction and all of this unsexy energy, and they could just focus.
With the director screaming at them.
Yeah. Yep.
Give me a little more action. And for them, it was just a day at work. And then when they had to shoot the softcore stuff, that looked even harder because you don't have your dick inside. So it's boom, 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 boom. Like literally, it's like a physical, an athletic activity, and their dick is not inside. And they were just, it was amazing to watch how they shot the softcore part.
Because they'll do two different versions,
yeah, for close-ups.
Oh, right. Wow.
What? For the close-ups they had.
What's the two different versions?
One inserting, one,
I guess maybe, part. What, maybe it hit Showtime, the movie, or something like that?
I forget why they were doing it. Maybe now they just cut it differently, but they were doing something for softcore. With a dick, they had to shoot it a certain way where the cock was not, you couldn't see the cock going in. I don't remember why, it's 13 years ago, but.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
That's so crazy, man.
You're going to be back on porn by the end of the day, Theo.
Yeah,
Vaughn.
This is in a good spot.
But you watched that, though, and like I said, it didn't feel sexy at all. It didn't feel like.
I would find it fascinating.
It was fascinating.
More than sexy. I would love to just check that whole thing out and how it actually is made.
Like, yeah. I never knock porn people or knock porn actors because to me, like, what they do, like, you know, yeah, I understand it's hard to act for real, but there is not a person in Hollywood that could pull off what porn people do. Like, to stand there with your dick hard in a gravel driveway, fucking a girl, yeah, while fucking six guys are filming you with a light.
Well, I'm imagining they're on the pills, though, too, to help.
I've been on Cialis, dude. It doesn't matter. I can take a fucking 20 milligram Cialis, and if there's something wrong happening, my dick is still like, I'm so
really? Yeah, that's how I am. I'll pop 5 milli if I'm even, I got to have a few milligrams sometimes if it's in like a new environment.
Sure.
What do you mean? What, a new chick?
Yeah, it's my head's so tied into whatever's going on that I got to really be, I got to have a little bit of, you know, sometimes you want a little bit of assistance in the tank. You
is
know?
That what porn did for you too? Like, because for me, porn, like, your head is so wrapped up in it that, when you stop watching it, your head frees up a little bit. Like, whew, now I can feel things again. And
yeah,
it's
that's
not
the
just
problem. I just can't feel anything. I'm just watching.
Yeah.
So
when
you're
when you would blow loads, this is what I used to do when I was younger. I didn't realize
Jesus
I did
Christ.
It. When you blow loads, I would always picture myself watching myself fucking. Like, I would never be picturing myself feeling sex.
Right.
And as I'm coming, I'm picturing myself watching me
like
fucking.
Cameron Crowe.
Yeah, it was so crazy. It was so crazy.
James Cameron, sorry.
But Cameron Crowe was okay. I was throwing a phone at a girl's head.
I don't know who Cameron Crowe is.
Oh, he's an actor.
Yes, he is.
I'm thinking of Russell Crowe.
Russell Crowe.
Oh, yeah.
So we're all crowed
up. Is Cameron Crowe an actor? Yeah, he's an actor.
Yeah.
Cameron Crowe.
No, Cameron Crowe's a director.
Oh, he is. And then
Russell Crowe.
Russell, yeah, actor, okay. And then James Cameron. We're all fucked up.
It's all over the place now. Hey, E-Rock, you said you had one more thing about Ghostbusters.
Yeah, before you change subject.
Well, we did 20 minutes ago, but well, now we're going back to it.
Yes, because
and then
part's
I want to find out the answer to that.
Because this part was important. There is one of the biggest problems with the movie is that the whole underline is that men are stupid. Men are idiots. Men can't.
Oh yeah, that's gonna drive guys a bit crazy.
Yeah, it's more than one instance. There's a lot of quick throwaway lines. They're just saying like, oh, a guy couldn't do this, or a guy's an idiot, and there's a safety line right here. Oh, that's for guys. Women just go balls to the wall.
Yeah. Oh, I like it. It's fun for the gals. You go on with yourself back
yeah, the
there.
Roles have been reversed.
It's not even roles.
It's emasculating.
That's going to piss off some people.
It's blatantly saying.
Yeah, we're more powerful
it's
than
it's going to kill our grandfathers.
Man. Yes. My goal is to see Nick DiPaolo enjoy that movie.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. We should set up a screening.
We should.
Where you get to see Ghostbusters with Nick DiPaolo. Oh, we'll. This movie will drive him nuts. Yes. I liked it. Whatever.
It'll annoy Nick so much he won't even yell.
Right.
It'll bother him so much he'll be like, well, it's just another example. He'll be calm. It'll bother him so much he'll go back to calm.
And I heard you guys talking about Johnny Depp. I saw him at the Comedy Store the night that he came in. Has he been in here?
No. No, we never had Johnny.
It was pretty crazy. He was there with Doug Stanhope.
They're good friends.
Good friends.
Yeah. And I tried to go meet him, so I went back in the green room because I know Doug. And then I got to Doug, and I could barely even talk to Doug. So I realized that I wasn't going to be able to move on to Johnny, so I just left.
Why couldn't you just say hi to Johnny?
I think I maybe could have just kind of played it up in my head. And when I went into the green room, there was more people in there than I expected. There was a couple of Italians in there and people cigarette smoke in the air, different than usual. Was that an Italian?
Yes, it was.
I thought it was.
Did he have any people around them, any bodyguards, Johnny?
Yeah, there's a couple of guys. And then there he was, and he looked like, like this little Christmas tree.
So you were in the room with him.
Yeah.
But you thought, all right, I got to have a good conversation with Doug Stanhope, and then it'll lead me to Johnny.
Yeah, well, I just wanted to say hey to Doug, and then I think I would have been like, hey, can you introduce me? And he would have.
Yeah,
I just couldn't communicate with Doug super well, and then I was like, I'm going to step back and just
cut my losses.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would have said to him, I thought Donnie Brasco was a terrific performance.
Nice.
One thing you wanted to know about him jerking off. No, but I wanted him to answer something. There was something you were going to answer.
Yeah, I'm trying to quit pornography, and I just
there's a question I had
because you said that you pictured yourself fucking somebody when you came when you.
Oh yeah, because you were saying Cialis helps you out and like
sometimes
it's in your head too much. I'm like, would you do that or no? You wouldn't picture yourself fucking people when you came. You would picture yourself being in the scene.
Yeah, I don't really think about it that hard. I mean, I don't think I'm able to. I mean, I just feel like I have less feelings. If more pornography I watch, the less feelings I have.
What? So if you pick up some girl, you don't really want to fuck her because you've been jerking off too much?
Yeah, or you're like, if I just jerked off yesterday and I just meet some gal, like, I'm going to be like, maybe I'll run into her again in a couple days when I haven't jerked off.
I jerked off last night because fucking Robert Kelly wanted to come over, and I'm like, I had a very urge to go do something really bad, and I'm like, no, choose friendship.
Yeah.
See your friend. Don't go out.
It's Tony Robbins
and
right
be
there.
A fucking creep.
Breakthrough.
He had a breakthrough.
Come all over yourself. Choose friendship. And then 30 seconds after Bob is there, I'm like, why did I make this horrible decision? You know what, dude? You relax. You got your apartment, friendship. And I'm like, I could be fucking coming on somebody right now. So listening to
did you see him snorkeling on Instagram?
I did not.
He was enjoying his time. Where was he? Aruba again?
He
loves snorkeling and getting away a little bit.
I didn't see that.
Nothing bad.
I didn't see that.
I don't want to see that.
Bobby just enjoys his snorkeling when he can.
I like watching men snorkel, man.
Eric, one more thing on Ghostbusters?
No, I was saying line one.
Oh, line one.
For what you're discussing.
How do I... We have brand new phones. I don't know how to...
You click the green button there on the left.
Did this work? No? How about
click it.
This?
Yeah.
Wow, first call with the new phone system. Who's this, Kelly?
Hey guys, what's going on?
What's going on, buddy?
I am an actor, and I've done two of those softcore porno, well, they weren't really porno films, but they had those softcore films, those scenes in them, and it really does suck, man. It is horrible. It sucks.
Did you have to shoot? All right, now, did you ever do hardcore, or you only did softcore?
I never did hardcore, no. I just did, like, there was actually no, we were both naked. Well, she was completely naked both times, both movies. I had a sock and a rubber band around my penis.
Okay.
And my balls and everything. But yeah, no, I didn't do any penetration, but it really was no fun at all after the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, because you realize you're slamming up against this person, and you're not even getting, the your dick's not getting anything out of it. It's got to kind of point down.
Well, Jimmy, honestly, I'm a bit of a pervert, too, so I had a little bit of wood, more than a little bit, actually, the first time. And the first time, the girl was flattered. I'm like, look, I'm really sorry. I'm poking you. I'm really, you know, I don't know. I think she would have probably done it the first one. The second one, this girl was a bitch, and she was just getting real pissed. She even told the director, look, this guy keeps poking me. And so what they did was they had me cheat down a little bit. So I was, like, not really up against her actual vagina. I was a little bit lower, like, by her, by her thighs.
Wait, she got mad?
She got mad, and she said, we rehearsed it, and I'm poking her. I mean, I'm like, look, I'm sorry. Nothing I can do. I wasn't fully hard, obviously, but, you know, I had enough to poke her. And she was like, we get up after rehearsal. She said to the director, can I talk to you for a minute? Like, really angrily. Mm. Can I talk to you for a minute? And I'm like, oh, no, I knew what it was. And they go in the room, they come back, and he's like, listen, he said, Kelly, we're going to have to, you know, cheat down a little bit. He didn't really say the reason, but I knew that's what it was. And I said to him, look, I'm really sorry. I apologize. She was just, like, really turned.
Whoa, how do you do the scene after that? After she walks off mad and talks to the director, and then she comes back, and now you guys got to make believe everything's cool. That's got to be strange, and filming a porn, especially.
You're apologizing for the exact opposite reason of why I've had to apologize. Sorry, there's nothing happening here.
I focused on the check, honestly. I really said, because I'm like, this girl's a bitch. I'm like, you're making me feel uncomfortable for this? I'm like, it's not my fault, and... You know what it was in the whole script? It wasn't a total porno movie. It was like a regular, like one of these, you know, it's almost like a Lady Chatterley's Lover type of movie where she wasn't, you know, she wasn't supposed to be getting fucked the entire movie. She was only supposed to have like two sex scenes, one with me, and one with another guy. And that particular day was my second day. We already had our sex scene. It was a threesome.
Ooh. Mm.
We were only supposed to be doing yoga. That was the whole scene. We were supposed to be doing yoga, and not naked, just normal yoga. And
it's like the worst movie.
I get to the set, they're like, hey, you know you're gonna be naked again. I'm like, what are you talking about? They're like, well, it's another sex scene. I'm like, no, it's not, it's on the script. So I think the girl was really pissed because she ended up literally getting fucked in every scene, and by the time she got to me again, she was just, I think she was mad that she didn't sign up for that.
So what did she think? What did she think? This was her big fucking breakthrough, and this was the yoga scene that was going to put her over the top? What is she doing?
I don't know.
It sounds like it's not even a movie about sex, and this girl's just getting banged in every scene.
What was the name of the movie? Yeah.
Vinyasa.
So the name of the movie, they changed it, but it was called Mallory's Final Score. It was about a girl who was a very talented musician, like at Juilliard, but she had no passion. So she was really talented technically, and she could really write a good score, like musically. She was a musician, but she decided to explore her horizon to become more passionate by becoming a prostitute.
Well, let me ask you this:
What was the new name of it?
You know what? I was trying to think of what I was on hold. I really can't remember because it did come out. It came out. I remember I got the email.
Eat, pray, yuck.
What was it, like a Showtime movie or Cinemax? One of those softcore.
Yeah, one of those.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it, but it's probably going to make the rounds. It only came out about 8 months ago.
So are you still in the business, Kelly?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely.
All right.
Sounds like it's for that.
I have a legitimate play coming out in September. Maybe I'll give you guys a call back.
I think they changed it to Her Composition. Is that possible?
Yeah, Her Composition. That's exactly what it was.
Let me see, Kelly. Are you in the credits here?
Wait a minute. No. Rachel Feinstein is in this?
It wasn't Rachel Feinstein, though. It was a girl named Jocelyn or Jacqueline.
Jocelyn. You got Jocelyn Jensen?
Jocelyn Jensen, the bitch.
So it's not a softcore porn. Obviously,
you got Rachel Feinstein in this.
No, it turned into, like I said, it was supposed to be a regular movie, but like I said, this girl was getting banged in every scene, so she was pissed.
Oh, I see. I'm sorry.
Gotcha.
The girl from Welcome to the Dollhouse is in it, too. Heather, whatever, is in it.
Oh, right.
Heather Matarazzo.
Wiener Dog was in it. That's right.
Hmm. But you didn't get a credit there, Kelly. The fuck?
Well, Kelly's not my real name, bro.
Oh, Peckles.
Ah, Pagans.
Forget it. All right, well, thank you guys for listening, and have a good day.
Bro. All right, Kelly, take
right
care.
On, I had to do a movie with Jenna Fischer from The Office where I had a dry humper for a while. And just dry humping like her inner thigh. I had a little G-string on with a little sock on my dick, too.
Were you turned on?
Yeah, a couple times.
Was she mad?
No, she said, she goes, I would take it as an insult if you didn't.
Do you clear stuff on her leg?
The one time I got up after one take, I was packing, I had a soggy six, and my balls were hanging out of like the little socks. So the balls were hanging low. My mule was just out there, and it was, I was just like, oh, sorry. Everyone's just like, no, don't worry about it. It was embarrassing. I got three rods out of like 14 takes.
Mm-mm. I think we found the guy. I think we found your scene. Do you have longer hair and facial hair?
No, I got a big tattoo on my back, like a big tattoo of a.
All right, because we're on Mr. Okay. Skin, Jim Norton's favorite website.
Oh. You don't like it?
No.
Jim Florentine, I called in once before, and I called in to talk to you about that movie that you just talked about with Jenna Fischer.
Yeah, a little help.
You might remember that I said you were really good. I called in and said that. I enjoy your performance. You were supposed to be like a real scumbag, and you were.
Man, yeah, I wasn't. Football. Yeah, it was easy to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good.
All right. Thanks. Thank you, Kelly.
Bangs Bus, too. Bangs Bus. That's Jim's other favorite site.
Oh, those ones are okay. This one.
All right. Listen, we should take a break. I don't know how to hang up on the the new phone system, so that guy's just sitting there. I can't figure it out. Jim Florentine in studio. What do you got going on, Jim?
Next week, I'm at the Funny Bone in Omaha, Nebraska. And then July 20th, Hard Rock Casino, Sioux City, Iowa.
All right, right on. And Theo Vaughn, what do you got, buddy?
I'm going to be in Naples, Florida.
Nice.
Coming up July 7th. July later this month. And then September 2nd and 3rd, I'll be here in New York at Gotham, New York City.
And I have a couple of things. I have Columbus coming up, and I have the 20th, I think it is, or the 21st. I'll be in Columbus, Ohio. And I have the Gathering of the Juggalos the next night. And I also, my Pittsburgh date is being moved because I had to, like I said, move some stuff around. So the Pittsburgh, I believe, date is being moved to September. I should have that. I'll tell you the next time we come back. I don't remember.
Or JimNorton.com.
Go to JimNorton.com.
For all your updates on Jimmy Torn and everything else.
And the UFC Unfiltered podcast is out. We have a new one coming out Thursday. And it's doing really, really well. So I appreciate the people who are listening to it.
Excellent.
And enjoying it.
Very cool. We got royalty coming in a little bit. Robert Kennedy Jr. Royalty. Yeah.
Lee Harvey Oswald went to my middle school.
You want to bring that up?
Did he really? No, he did.
You want to bring that up today?
What lunch was he in?
I don't
know. That's funny.
I don't know.
I'm going to give him a two.
Yeah.
Yeah, two? Yeah,
I'm going to go two. Yeah.
He wasn't in three?
No, that would be...
But he did.
He wouldn't be able to get things done if he was three.
He did, man. Oh, he really did.
So you probably got your books from that building.
I don't know. I mean, they had a small tour around our town where you could go see the place where he lived at and stuff. It was just a basic place.
Who lives in that house now?
I'm not sure. I think it's a furniture store now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
But we got Robert F. Kennedy Jr. coming in. He's got a new book out called Framed. He's talking about a cousin, right?
Yes, Edward Skakel, who did 10 years in jail for the murder of Martha Moxley, who was killed in 75. Michael Skakel, and she was beaten to death with a fucking golf club, I think.
Yeah, that guy's nephew is a good buddy of mine, is a comedian at the Comedy Store, Earl Skakel.
Oh, right, I've heard the name before.
Yeah, okay. I know, yeah, Earl.
Yeah, you know Big Earl?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Related to Michael?
Yeah, he's related to Michael Skakel. That's crazy. I just heard about this 2 days ago. This is so full circle.
Mark Furman wrote a book about it, and I think that reopened the investigation, and then he got convicted. So I'd be interested to hear what was wrong, because he's saying that he did 10 years in jail he shouldn't have done.
Yeah, Robert F. Kennedy Jr., the whole book is about how he didn't commit this murder.
Wow.
So we just got the book.
But, you think he did it?
I don't know. I mean, I always did think he did it, and I remember reading stuff at the time, but we'll ask Robert what was wrong, and you know, like they said, there's no physical evidence. So I don't remember. I don't remember why I thought he did it.
This will be our second Kennedy in studio.
Really?
Not too shabby.
Well, the first one was the girl, Kennedy.
Oh, Kennedy. That's awesome. She's cool.
Who was it? It was I forgot her name.
The cute
she
boy.
She did the documentary on her father.
Oh, Ethel.
Fred Robert Durst.
Oh my God.
No, I know who you mean. Yeah, we had the girl. I forgot she was in.
Robert Durst is the guy.
Chip Kennedy.
would love to get Robert Thurston.
Yeah.
Yeah, I killed them all.
Yeah.
I did it.
I killed them all.
I killed them
all. Y'all need to get more murderers, man, in here.
We've had a few.
Well, you killed a dog.
Yeah. Yeah, starter stuff, though. That's starter stuff.
That's true. I kill sadness. That's what laughter
Florentine
is.
Florentine killed those bangs.
We've had some murderers. Yeah, Rory. Thank you. Rory Kennedy, for the people that need the answer. Oh, she was in here. We've had murderers in. Don King.
Oh, wow.
Who else? Who else?
It's a great,
how many murderers have we had in studio that we know of?
Probably some rappers.
Rich Voss. Awesome. He murders.
Yeah.
You said Rick Ross.
Rick Ross.
I heard Rich Voss out of that.
Rick Ross has never been convicted of a murder, though. I don't know if he's ever been like even accused of a particular murder.
Yeah, we're talking about the legit murderers.
I'm trying to think if I know. I have a buddy.
Oh, El Chapo. He was in.
El Chapo?
Yes. Promoting cowboy hat sales.
Between prison breaks, he came through.
I had a buddy who said he'd murdered someone once, and he said, I remember, it was the most relaxing thing he's ever done in his life.
Wow.
Which is pretty crazy to hear.
What's the story?
A truck the first time?
He didn't get into it super much. He just said that, and he said it was extremely relaxing. You'd be surprised.
Did he do time for it?
Mm-mm.
You never went to the cops?
No, it's none of my business.
I don't want to be late for his job.
Right. That's true.
He really loved being a busboy.
That's great. That seafood restaurant. Was it a Red Lobster at least?
It was just this little spot, man. But one of the girls who David Duke used to date, one of the waitresses there at my work. This hot blonde.
Was she black?
White gal. And I used to go lift weights with him, actually. We shared a back fence. You know what I'm talking about? The Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah.
We know David Duke, of course.
Some people don't know him. And he used to take me to the gym with him sometimes back in the day. And we go lift weights.
Would you lift crosses?
I don't know. And I'll say this. Nice guy.
Usually they are,
exactly.
Right?
Usually somebody who's so correct in their outlook isn't nice, but he's good, yeah, too.
And a lot of good workout pointers. There's a couple things, that techniques he taught me that I still use this day.
You didn't have a problem working out with him?
No, because I didn't know him like that. You know, I figured maybe that could have been a past part of his life. And you heard rumors and stuff, but I just knew him as, you know, this guy that was kind of making love to this hot lady that worked with us. And we're envious of that. And then he was in great shape. But I'm sure he was seedy after reading up on him a little bit, you know?
Right. But you still got those workout points.
He didn't try to recruit you or anything like that?
Nothing like that at all.
What tipped you off that there was something wrong? Like, you'd say, like, you know, I'm going to go over there and grab these black dumbbells and be like, stay away from them!
I don't know. Although, maybe you saw, I don't even know.
Yeah. All right, with that, we're going to take a break. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. on the way. We have Jim Florentine and Theo Von today. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. in a little while.
Yeah, man. Lee Harvey Oswald, baby.
I wanted to ask Florentine about this Pokemon thing. Are you all about it or what, man?
I don't know much about it.
This is in your wheelhouse.
I know. I've gotten like 50 emails in the last 3 days. You have to go off on this. I don't understand it yet. I have to do a little research on it.
They said more people have downloaded the new Pokemon game than Tinder. Or something like that in the paper today.
Which is probably easier to get laid than the Pokemon ones. That's why I'm getting it.
Oh, definitely, man. These kids will fall for anything.
I know Travis knows a lot about the game. I downloaded it for my son, and then I found myself playing it a little bit. What, Eric?
I just went, uh-huh.
No, I said it. Then I started playing it a little bit. It's a phenomenon.
And how many Pokemon did you catch?
I think I'm up to about, I could count them right now. No, less than 20.
Well, why
certainly.
Is this all of a sudden just caught on?
It just exploded.
It just came out.
So the app just came out and everyone.
Yeah. Everyone's talking about it, though. I was in some just who gives a fuck place getting lunch, and everyone in there was talking about it that worked at this place. and I just happened to download it literally 2 days ago for my son. And then, like I said, I got hooked on it a little bit. We're walking around, you know, New York and checking out the Pokemon and killing them and stuff.
Yeah.
But it's causing all sorts of strange issues, isn't it, Travis?
Yeah. People are getting robbed. People are finding dead bodies. People are having their homes, you know, visited by
how?
Strangers.
Okay. Where, what's the one?
Well, what do you want to hear about first?
I don't know where to begin with this because it's all over the place. How crazy this has gotten!
I've heard nothing about Pokemon.
Really, little girl was wandering around her neighborhood under a bridge and found a dead body because she was searching for a Pokemon that was in the area.
Oh,
all of a sudden these Pokemon characters pop up on your phone.
Mm-hmm. So the app is GPS based,
right?
So and it forces you to go outside and walk around to find these little creatures and then capture them. So, everybody's walking around and trying to find, these rare Pokemon and whatever. And just like Opie said, this girl, she's a 19-year-old girl. She's walking around.
There's a 19-year-old girl looking for Pokemon?
There's a 35-year-old man in this studio looking for one.
Who?
Me.
Yeah, Travis is in.
It's the dumbest.
The man part threw me.
Easy.
Travis is up to level 7, but maybe higher now.
Level 10.
Oh, now you're up to level 10.
So, when you
get up to level 5, then you get to fight other people.
Oh, really? Were you going around?
They got like Pokemon gyms. All of a sudden, you'll be on a corner.
That's my name.
That's his porn screen name.
See, I want to show the people I have a little knowledge on this. When you get up to level 5, then there's these gyms. So all of a sudden, you'll be walking on a corner in the game. There'll be a gym. You click in, and there's other people waiting there to fight you.
Wow.
I'm not up to level 5. I'm not privy to that.
But if you walked around New York looking for trying to capture Pokemon,
it's for my son. Yes.
Is he with you when you're walking around?
Yeah, you do.
No, you don't.
Well, you should be ashamed.
I mean, we walked around twice purposely to play the game. And then, when I was meeting Roland and Eric and everyone else at Ghostbusters last night on 23rd between 8th and 9th, I'm like, I'm down here. I might as well see if there's some action, some
good
Pokemon action.
And was
Thank
there?
You, Travis.
Some Pokemon action. For the kid, it's fine. I know if you're taking a 3-year-old around to catch some Pokey fucking men. That's cool. Like, I don't mind that. Like,
yep, kid stuff, no problem. But,
absolutely.
But when you're out and he's not there?
There was something wrong with the GPS, so nothing was really popping up. So, that's another thing with this game. It exploded so fast, there was all sorts of bugs and stuff.
There's lots of server issues. Yeah,
there's all
sorts
of problems.
But you were looking for him last night before Ghostbusters without your kid.
I certainly was.
All right.
It sounds like a real-life Ghostbusters, almost.
What the fuck are we doing? Everyone's running around looking for Pokemon on their phones.
It's just a stupid, fun game. That's all it is.
Did you put fun in there?
Nothing. Yeah, I did.
He did lead with stupid.
Okay.
I was never into Pokemon in the 90s. I have no knowledge about it. All I want to do is collect something stupid on my phone.
Really? That's what I've been doing. Sold photos of women with cocks.
When I was young, you got out.
Oh, you got it. Yeah, you're certainly collecting Pokemon. Jimmy's right in. He understands. I know I'm going to get sick of this very quickly. No? Unless the levels get cool where you get to do other things.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you have to like really stick at it, like
to
be good. And half
I'm
the
really
people, including myself,
I
like I'll be done.
How
are
you being good at just showing up and finding a Pokemon?
Because if you really want to know, because the more you level one up, then you can go to these gyms and then you can take control of the gym and you're on a team and you level your characters up and you get coins and you get more stuff and blah blah blah.
It sounds like you just need a lot of free time.
Yeah.
And then you can be good.
Yeah, basically, because you do have to go outside.
This is the beginning of something amazing, though. This is pretty cool.
I'm collecting eggs. What are the eggs?
Well, then you put the eggs in the incubator, and then they
I don't know where the incubator is.
I'll make an omelet.
Show you later.
Yeah. Are there incubators around the city?
No. You have it in your item.
Pokemon Gym's breakfast place.
Wait, so my eggs could be fucking hatching already?
Yeah, but you have to walk to hatch them.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, my God. What am I doing wrong?
Dude, when I was young, you got out and you found a body the old-fashioned way. You found a dead body the old-fashioned way. It's like being out and about.
On the train tracks in the 50s.
What else is going on with this game? I know a few businesses, their businesses through the roof because it's a spot where you can collect Pokeballs,
yeah, there's Poke spots and then there's, gyms. And they're all, you could see where they all are. So, some people, like this one guy, I forget what state he's in, but his house used to be a church. So these gyms and these spots are usually at monuments or like actual places. So they designated his house as a Poke spot. So people are showing up at all hours of the night to go there and do their stupid shit.
What are they supposed to do when they get to that house?
You have to be close enough to collect this stuff. So if it's a gym, you got to be in the area, and then other people are in the area, and then
So you don't have to walk into the house or the gym.
No, you just have to be in the
vicinity.
In the vicinity.
Yeah. Can I put my apartment as a place of like something? Whatever girls would need for Pokemon. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? This is the Pokemon fucking tit suck area.
One guy was in the paper today. He was so excited because his business was designated as a spot for the Pokemon game. So people happen to be in the area, and they're like, oh, fuck it, might as well get a slice of pizza because I'm here. And his business went through the fucking roof.
Mm. Yeah, it's helpful. I mean, look, it's a Nintendo game, and Nintendo's stock went up 25%. It's added like $12 billion to their bottom line.
What they ought to just do is sell it right now. That's what I would do.
Yeah,
because as soon as people get sick of it, it's going to go right back down.
Yeah, what's next, though? I wonder. What's, I mean, when this is the world is now a video game, right?
Right. This is just the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just.
No, you're right.
No, there'll be another thing. I don't know what's next, but this is the beginning, so you can only imagine how it's going to develop.
Like, we're
going to
be Pac-Man gobbling soon. I can't wait. Everybody's going to run around yelling waka 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 waka.
Speaking of ghosts. Pac-Man, ghosts.
Not everyone likes their place. What, Eric?
Not everybody likes their place being a hotspot for Pokemon.
Oh, yeah.
There's this guy in Massachusetts who...
Of course.
The GPS is reading an old map, so it looks like his house is a park, and people are showing up on his lawn and his driveway and everything by the hundreds doing this Pokemon thing in the front of his house, and he's freaking out about
some
it.
People don't like it.
And they won't change it.
Why won't they change?
Because their policy is that if it's not a physical danger to the people playing the game, they won't alter the maps.
Yeah, but I see lawsuits, man.
The first lawyer that calls, they'll change it.
Yeah, this guy's going to march out onto his lawn, punch one of these kids in the face, break his jaw, and then somehow they're going to try to sue Nintendo over that.
Or they're going to sue Nintendo over the fact that people are invading their privacy. Believe me, they're going to change
it. I feel
it.
Like there's going to be lawsuits. It's all fun and games now, but one incident's going to pop up in the next couple of days where everyone's like, oh, fuck.
Somebody's going to die. Something bad's going to happen.
Well, they're robbing people.
Yeah, so
who is?
So that's stabbing people.
So that's the
Pokemon.
In Missouri.
Oh, my God.
Are the Pokemon? I don't know how to say it.
They're fighting back?
Yeah.
Well, because you're wandering into these areas, and all of a sudden, you know, there's bad dudes waiting for you.
Yeah.
And they're robbing people.
Yeah, so anyone can see where these, if you've got the app, you could see where these Pokespots and these gyms are. So in, you know, areas that are more, you know, off the beaten path.
Detroit.
People are waiting because they know that people are going to come.
Oh, my God.
And then, you know, you're walking up there with your eyes on your phone because you're waiting to see, you know, your stupid Pokemon game, and people are getting held up at gunpoint.
I've never heard anything that made me happier.
I know.
You think they deserve it?
Absolutely.
I'm going to join them.
Absolutely. I was sodomized. What happened? I was centipeding. Got my asshole fucked while I was centipeding.
Oh, our servers are experiencing issues. I was going to open up my Pokemon app for Jim Florentine.
Oh, wow. That happened at a restaurant once I was at.
I want to try to turn you on to this.
Yeah.
Well, please come back later, it says.
Well, they have now like this whole like... Because they know you're a grown-up and you shouldn't be looking at them. You know, they know your son's not around. You're like, no, he's not. He's not. He's not looking at this.
I can come in and show you.
Why is yours working and mine's not?
It's probably a level 10 thing.
Now men are getting together and doing
that. That's too old.
I see.
Dude, I was at the mall. I was at the mall on Saturday, and literally everyone was swear to God.
Theo, it's really strange.
I got to get in.
No, just walking around New York City after this show, you will see people looking down at their phone. This thing exploded. You will see people looking down, and you will know they are playing
this
game.
That's the only reason I downloaded it was because everyone was talking about it.
Wait till porn does it.
Yeah.
You know, although there's a big mouth and giant fucking tits under this bridge. Yeah, that'll be a great thing.
Glory hole on top of these monkey bars.
I'm having problems opening mine up.
I just can't understand what's next, though. That's what I'm worried about.
I don't know.
Don't be worried.
Don't worry.
No, I don't worry about
that.
Okay, so these are all pokey stops. And...
That got you excited, huh?
Somebody hit high score.
So it'll tell you where to go.
I don't know how to read that stupid map.
It's just a thing. It's a map. And look, that's the waterfall sculpture that you walk past like a million times.
Where?
Right down the street.
I don't see a waterfall sculpture, you piece of garbage.
That's that waterfall.
Oh, yeah.
The hole
when it opens
in the middle
like
of the waterfall.
It's a circle. Then you can click on it and swipe. And look, I'm getting balls.
Oh, boy, have I been there.
Oh, boy. And that's it. And then you wait for Pokemon to come. And
wait, you were close enough to get the balls?
Worst. Yeah, yeah, this building's the
How
best.
Are you close enough to get the balls?
Because it's right below us.
That's wow.
Just,
just, I don't,
it's
this
just
is,
a stupid game.
I know, but it's just, mean, Jim, comment? There you go. I don't disagree.
That's it.
What's something to do while you walk to the subway?
Well, now you know about the game. Everyone's texting you and emailing you about it. So
yeah,
now
no,
you got
absolutely.
Knowledge on it.
I'm going to do some research
on
it.
So you should download the app and enjoy yourself.
How brilliant are people, though? Armed robbers are using the mobile game to lure players into a trap. I mean, there are people who are just criminals are genius.
Armed robbers. You got to respect that. Yeah, absolutely. In a way. You do, right?
Yeah.
That's genius.
Oh, they I remember these kids put up a, this family put up a stop sign in our neighborhood. Wasn't even theirs. They just put it in the neighborhood, and then they would sell dope right there, so people would stop. And they had it up for years. They just barred it from somewhere else.
Wait, wouldn't they take the stop sign down at the end of the day?
No, I just left it.
They
up.
Just left it up.
So they'd run out to the car when they stopped. Say, "Hey, you want any dope?"
Yeah, boom. But what a great you create your own hub of commerce right there. You know, and that's what they're doing here: new stop signs.
Oh, here's a Pokemon.
Oh, you found a Pokemon?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They're selling everything down there now: T-shirts, malts.
Okay, that's a. So you see it uses augmented reality, so it's right there.
Yeah, it's
swipe and try to catch him.
Oh, fucking stinks this game. You swipe it. You got him, now what happens?
Well, let's see if I got him. Sometimes they escape.
I understand.
See, it's a whole thing. Look, he escaped.
Oh, no.
It's not fun when they escape. Man injured while hit by car. See, the stories are coming in. Where was that out of Colorado Springs parking lot? Guys just...
Oh, didn't get him.
Oh, you're actually filming it through your camera.
Yeah,
that's pretty cool. But to me, it's that whole little Pokeball thing is shit. But the idea, what you see, what this is going there to become, that's amazing.
But what's next? I mean, like, I guess if you could,
Like once we have on the fucking the helmets, all the let's just say those virtual reality things.
Yeah,
once virtual reality, and you don't have to swipe on your phone.
And you can live it.
And you can live it, and there's little things you can hook up where you feel like you're getting your dick sucked, or you feel like you're getting punched, or you feel like you're flying. That, to me, will be the amazing thing.
Yeah.
Didn't I read, I'm going to need help on this because I didn't think this was going to come up today. They had some kind of virtual reality sex convention that they had to cancel because too many people showed up or something like that.
Well, you bet I'd go there. Who's got me high-fiving?
Someone can help me out with the link. I came across something like that, but because they all went to have the whole virtual sex experience.
Mm. I remember one time I ate at Ambien, actually. I was on a flight, and I had a sex dream. You know that, where you think about sex in your head, and you start kind of acting it out in real life, you know, a little bit?
Yeah. You wake up, you're fucking biting the pillow, your ass is in the air.
That took a turn.
So that's what happened. I got on this plane, and I had this sex dream that I was doing oral sex with this woman. And so I was acting it out with, like, my tongue and mouth open in the air. I didn't realize it. And this man shakes me, and I guess he'd sat down next to me on the plane. We're in the air, and he's like, "Get it together, son." That's what he told me.
Fuck that. I would not wake you up. I would enjoy that.
I'd stand up and pull my dick out.
So you were like, had your tongue out? Like,
yeah,
you were
I in my head, I fully was there, man.
So get it together, son?
Huh?
He said, "Get it together."
He said, "Get it together, son."
So you can't take Ambien.
Yeah, I'm not taking Ambien, but I miss that kind of stuff. Like, this is faking it. You
did
know?
You hear the story while we were off about the guy that thought he was in a plane crash?
No.
And they got audio?
No, I didn't hear that either.
It's an Ambien story. He called 911 and said he was in a plane crash. And it turns out he was on Ambien.
That's awesome.
Well, where was he calling from? Trying to cornfield?
They got part of the 911 call. I was trying to find a longer version of this. Man taking Ambien calls 911, imagines he's in a plane crash. You guys didn't hear this over the break? My God. You got to hear this.
How can you even imagine that?
And he's very convincing.
Yeah.
It's like, I didn't need help. I was in a plane crash.
How old is he?
He's an older gentleman.
How old?
I think it says 75 here. Okay, yeah.
Oh, no.
I know he's older.
That's the worst.
Oh, no. But he said train wreck, but he meant his marriage.
He really didn't sound 75, though.
Well, they say a plane crash takes off a few years. That's what they say.
Play that. It's a news story, and they only play part of the 911 call, so it might be, you got to hear this. Especially after Theo Von's Ambien story.
Yeah, I mean, it just...
Sitting through a commercial. We'll have it in a second here. And I also found the story about the...
Did you say anything else to the guy after he said, "Get it together"? Did you tell him you're sorry?
I did say I was sorry.
Because I don't think he should have to be subjected to that just because I might be going through some stuff in my head, you know?
You think maybe during your dream, maybe you reached over and grabbed his dick?
Mm-mm. I've never done anything like that.
Well, you were
It'd
on
be
Ambien,
okay,
no.
though. You're on Ambien.
Yeah.
That's true. That's a good point.
It's not gay if you're on Ambien.
That's true. I had a buddy, I had a guy, a man ejaculate on my arm once at the movies when I was growing up.
Yeah, you told us that one.
Yeah.
That's not gay, right?
I mean, it didn't feel gay.
How long did you leave it on there for?
Just till the movie ended. I don't want to be rude.
Here's the Ambien story with the plane crash. Check this out.
About a plane crash ended up being a bad dream, quite literally. Dream. We've now confirmed that a disoriented man had taken Ambien before making that call for help.
Como's Suzanne Fawn takes a closer look at the concerns about the popular prescribed drug.
From this quiet neighborhood in Renton came a phone call pleading for help. A 75-year-old man called dispatch at 2 in the morning to say he had been in a plane crash.
Are you able to safely get out?
No, I'm pinned in.
The caller said he was in a small cargo plane with 3 unconscious people.
Are you able to look out the window? Are you able to see the wing from where you're at?
No, I can't see anything.
But turns out he imagined the whole thing after taking Ambien before bed. The 911 caller didn't want to talk to us on camera, but he did express how concerned he is about the side effects of Ambien. He said he had only taken half a pill because he couldn't sleep after having surgery.
It must have seemed really real to him for him to have called 911.
You think?
Dr. Gandhis Mazika is a sleep expert with Sound Sleep Health.
You're a sleep expert. You should be able to come up with something better than that.
Yeah. Almost like a real hallucination for him. And that does speak
to some
of
Gandhis Mazika. That's a comforting name.
Mazika says Ambien is one of the most popular prescribed drugs in the U.S. He says it's safe, but there are times when it can cause problems.
It can cause people to have this kind of disorientation if it's given to the
problems like what like you survive a plane crash. Sounds great.
Mm-hmm.
If the dosage is too high.
As for that grandfather from Renton, Dr. Mazika says the man could still have had other drugs in his system from his surgery.
By and large, if a person is already taking it and they're not experiencing side effects from it, there should not be a warning for them to stop taking it.
Doctors say you shouldn't take Ambien unless you have
stinks.
A prescription for it.
It's an amazing story, and then you got to listen to this guy just babble nonsense. Play the whole 911 call.
Well, plus, they couldn't get the guy. They probably would have. Right. They had to fill because the guy wouldn't come on camera.
Yeah. Because, I mean, that's amazing. They should release the entire 911 call. I don't think there's any more. That's pretty much all I heard as far as the call goes. If anyone knows where a longer version is, please send it to us.
Yeah, they've had some great stuff. Somebody ate a pack of cigarettes on Ambien, I heard. What else is out there? A couple different things are out there. People are doing on it.
Yeah.
A lot of people that freak out on planes are on Ambien. When they get escorted off the plane, they got to make an emergency landing. Oh. Or cops are waiting for them. A lot of times it's Ambien. They mixed it with a glass of wine.
Right.
Or something, yeah.
Well, I can't fuck with it. I took it. I've taken it once or twice. But it was for sleep studies when I had to go in because I needed to sleep. And I was like, I'm not going to be able to sleep. So I used it to help me sleep so they could get the results they wanted from the apnea machine.
But wouldn't that fuck up? Oh, okay. I was going to ask, wouldn't that fuck up the results? But if they're looking at for the apnea
while you're
asleep, right?
Sleep study's bizarre, isn't it?
I don't know.
You have to sleep with a mask on. Yeah, I have enough trouble sleeping. I woke up again this morning. My nose felt like there was somebody had their fucking thumb in my nose, my shitty sinuses. So I just don't sleep. And I haven't taken the mask out in 6 months.
And we had Bear Grylls in here yesterday. Mm-hmm. He was talking about how he slept in a camel's carcass.
No way.
Resting his head on the animal's dead head.
Yeah. Dang.
And he slept. Jimmy, in a perfect environment, can't sleep.
I can't sleep on a king bed. This guy's fucking hanging out of a fucking giraffe's asshole, catching Z's.
Knowing there's cheetahs in the area, and he could still get some good shut eye. Bear Grylls is pretty amazing.
Is he a cool guy?
He's awesome. We've had him on many times over the years. He's a great guy. We got a news anchor hunting for Pokemon during a live weather report.
Yeah.
Okay.
You want to hear this?
This is probably a setup. I bet this is a news setup. Let's see.
This is for Florentine.
84 in St. Pete right now. Got a Pokemon? She's looking for Pokemon right now. This is the location.
Oh my God, this is amazing.
This is Pokemon. You're just walking around all over the place. 81 in Safety Harbor in Largo. 80 in Seminole.
Be funny if it wasn't a Pokemon, but she held up her phone, and one of the production guys had sent a picture of his black dick, and she was trying to go over there and see it in person.
She knew it was time. She got the call.
Couple brothers.
Ah, no people. Reason he should have laughed at that.
No,
long.
No. What? They're just having fun with this thing. It's an upset, you know, phenomenon, I should say.
Within 3 weeks, it'll be over.
Depends on what happens.
Travis, three like weeks? Friday. Give it?
I mean, I'll probably be done within 3 weeks.
But you think 3 weeks pretty much everyone move on to something?
No, I don't, because Pokemon apparently never went away. Like, it's still, like,
it's always
insanely
been a thing.
Popular yeah. on, like, the Nintendo DS and stuff like that. So I think that the people who really, really love it and are super excited about this are going to play it forever. But people like me and Opie, yeah, I'll be done with it within 3 weeks.
Well, I think I'll play with my kid for a little longer. But he'll get bored.
They lose interest.
Yeah, he'll get bored with it, though.
The kids will get bored. But people are going to start meeting up. More crime's going to happen.
Sorry, I'm signing into my Pokemon app.
I knew what that was.
Yes, I want to. I need to get those balls. I didn't know we could get the balls from this high up. Turn this fucking thing down. Sorry. Just happy I figured out how to get the app to work. Here it is. Premature evacuation. All right. Sex festival is forced to shut down early because too many people arrived to try out virtual reality porn. Why would you shut it down?
It was just a capacity thing.
It was in Tokyo.
Of course.
Not enough bracelets for everyone.
Of course, Tokyo. They all show up to put on their helmets and pretend they're fucking. What a weird culture.
Is that what they do there?
They do all weird panties in a thing. Just a bizarre group.
In the vending machine?
Ugh,
the panties in a vending machine?
Yes.
And you've been over there, haven't you?
Never.
You haven't?
No, but I mean to go. No, I've never gone.
Have you been, Theo? Are you a world traveler?
I've been to Tokyo. I've been to Africa a good bit. Now, that's where you really see some, I feel like, adventurous activity out there.
Like what?
I had a buddy of mine got a blowjob at the Florida bar outside of Mombasa, and he comes up to me, and he's like, man, I'm scared. And I was like, what's going on? He's like, you know, I think I cut my penis on my zipper. And I was like, well, dude, got him a glass of vodka, and he held his penis in a glass of vodka for the rest of the night. Just to kind of desensitize, you know, to get the sting out, whatever he could have. But yeah, I've had a good time in some.
Wait, so he got blown, and then did the girl do it to him, or did
no,
he actually
cut on the zipper? He was just worried that he could have caught something. Yeah,
so he kept his dick in the vodka.
In the vodka, yeah, pretty cool.
All night.
Yeah, he was very nervous, boy. Very nervous, boy.
And you didn't get blown over there.
I didn't get blown over there. I usually keep it pretty casual.
Who drank the vodka countries. After this guy? Someone, you know, there's some idiot around.
Some
like,
friend.
Come on, you know.
I was at a party one night when Steve-O had some guy come on stage and drink a glass of his own urine one time, which was pretty nuts. I thought
they say it's healthy to drink urine.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't drink unless I was in an avalanche. I've thought about it. If I was in an avalanche, I would.
It would have to be an avalanche. Wouldn't you be too worried about what's chasing you?
No, an avalanche of snow. You already know what's chasing you. Snow, and it's got you pinned
but
down.
But, I mean, you're now pinned down is what you're saying.
How are you going to get the piss to your mouth from the? You're covered with fucking 400 tons of snow, and you what, are you going to tinkle in your hand and throw it up?
Yeah, probably.
If you have enough room to do that, can't you just get out of the fucking hole you're
yeah,
in?
Yeah, you probably
that's
could.
The hole's open at the top of your head.
If you're only covered from the thigh down, you could probably get out.
Sounds like someone's just coming finding an excuse to drink urine.
God, I would hate to be covered in avalanche.
Oh, it's free the whole time. Oh, fuck.
My brother used to do that when we were young. That used to be the thing, urinate on each other. Remember that? You guys do that?
No.
No.
No. Well, I have. Yeah, I don't have any brothers. Yeah, but... right on. Yes.
No, just what? Brothers
night,
or friends?
Yeah,
just...
at night, my brother would stand on my bed and urinate. It, like,
Jesus.
That was the thing, you know?
Just piss on you.
Yeah. Or if we had a friend over.
While he was sleeping?
Yeah, or just awake. You know, in the dark and kids surprise each other.
Right. I'm just looking at this. So,
nope, okay.
No.
Too many people showed up at this thing. Staff were left in tears and vowed to hold next event in a bigger venue. Festival features an airflow cardboard box that stimulates fondling a breast.
What?
These people are the people putting their lives on the line for adult VR. It's a whole article. But, I mean, look at this thing. Look at this.
That's gross. Get a friend. Huh? What is that?
I guess putting on the glasses fills in all the parts that are missing because you just got a torso there.
Yeah.
What is this?
It's so primitive. But that you know, let's see 50 years from now what it's like to fuck a mannequin. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah. But we're in the trial stages right now.
Sure.
I think that would probably be a pretty cool experience right now.
Yeah, we're gonna watch these videos someday. The way we look at Wright Brothers stuff, with the plane taking all like this is how this stuff is gonna look. Remember they used to fuck a torso, a weird torso with a mask on.
This is just gross, man.
Gross. Like, I'm making me want to stay alive forever. That encourages me.
Well, what happened in the days when like just singing together was fun for everybody? Remember that? Remember when you just
we realized that singing together is only it's only so satisfying to belt out a tune with a buddy. But if you can fuck
it, I guess it's
true. I'd rather fuck that.
What? Oh, Jesus. Come on, Florentine.
I would.
Get it together. Don't go off on his deep end.
Me and Jam sang an Ozzy song on a road trip once, and it was okay. I'd rather fuck that.
You're better than that.
No, I'm not.
No, I'm not.
He doesn't enjoy the finer things in life.
Come on, like man. What?
Pokemon.
Yeah, singing with a friend.
Singing with your pals.
Having a bowl
I've
of Ratatouille.
I've sang with my pals
ketchup.
Before.
Relax. How about ketchup? What's wrong with ketchup?
Yeah, it's got to be semen every time.
Well, look, I mean, come on. If when you're thirsty, you're thirsty.
Oh, what if you're an avalanche? How are you going to get it to your mouth?
French fries and cum. What a horrible treat.
Oh, now you're in the Swiss Alps.
Oh, my God. What are we looking at there, Iraq? That hand thing.
It was from, that jerk off machine with the VR goggles.
They actually built a jerk off machine. Look at that.
You lay under this thing, I'm guessing. You got the goggles.
Is that Andy Milonakis?
It's a robot hand, though. You can move the robot hand and adjust it.
But they're watching all that anime porn, though.
Dude, adjust it to pet your dog. That would be a great machine, huh?
Why don't you jerk yourself off? What do you need a fucking fake hand for?
I guess so. It feels like a stranger.
You should buy it, Jim.
Yeah, malfunctions. Fucking dick gets stuck in there.
Yeah.
I don't need
it. You ever fuck a fleshlight?
I don't do that, man. I like to do human activity if I can help it, you know? Straight up old fashioned.
Yeah.
Old fashioned.
No hand cream. Dry.
No, I mean, I used to do hand cream when I was younger, when I was starting out, but now I'm just a dry guy. But I'm trying to get out of it. I'm trying to get out of the masturbation. I'm trying to get out of, you know, it just gets dark, man.
But if you jerk off, like, on a Thursday night, you saying if you meet a chick at a show on a Friday, you're not going to want to have sex with her because you jerked off the night before?
Yeah, probably. I just don't care as much because you're beating your chi down, you know? So my chi's going, my desire, you know?
But I could see if you did it a couple times earlier that day and then you don't want to fuck the girl that night. But the night before, 24 hours before, you still don't feel it.
I mean, it's a little slow, maybe. I came out of 70-year-old genetics, bro. I came out of 70-year-old genetics, dude.
Sometimes it's good to get that one big load out of the way. You know what I mean?
So not for me.
That's all she's getting. That's all I got. One big load.
We got Thanksgiving, and then it's leftovers.
We got the first one out of the way, and the last. You missed out, sweetie.
How old would your dad be if he was alive today?
106. 106 years old.
That's fucked up.
Pretty bizarre, man. Pretty bizarre, dude. Because
you're a young dude.
Did he ever go to any of your, like, functions, if you played basketball or baseball or any of that shit?
One basketball game, fell asleep in the stands. He used to fall asleep in the carpool, and they would have to go wake him up, and it'd be all embarrassing. And he had this, he used to be a barker at colleges, which is where you'd, like, he'd get people to sign up for those credit cards. You know, people in the airport that's always bothering you? So he'd get people, so I'd go with him to the schools and stand up on the tables and start yelling, getting people to come over, which is maybe how I got a little bit of inkling for doing some stand-up, maybe, but so people would come over and that, but one of the things they gave the kids who signed up for credit cards was Kit Kats, free Kit Kats.
I love Kit Kats.
Yeah, people love them. And now sometimes on the weekends, he would have us clean out his car and he'd go park his car and he had this old Cutlass. And, he'd sleep in the car and we'd clean it out. And it was full of just whatever. And he had like some speakers in the back. One of them had Chinese food in it, actually. But we would, one time we started throwing these Kit Kats out to these squirrels in this park, right? And by the time we left, we had about 30 squirrels in this park eating Kit Kats from us. And about 2 days later, they found about 15 or 20 dead squirrels in this park. And they'd all died from eating this chocolate that we'd given them.
Why?
Because
the chocolate bad or their systems don't like it.
I think they just can't handle it.
Digested. Hey, I got to go back to the urine thing because we missed the obvious. We really missed the obvious. We got Joe in Milwaukee.
He's a
I can't believe none of us came up with this. I don't know how to work these new phones. Does that
Green
work?
Play.
All right, Joe in Milwaukee, go ahead.
Hey, Theo, you said it would take an avalanche for you to drink your own urine. What is that? Because you don't want to die of thirst, right?
Yeah, I think. I mean, at that point.
Well, how about you fucking eat the snow.
It's all oh,
yeah. Boy, Theo is going to be known as Urine Boy.
By the way, it takes 3 days to die of thirst. How long do you think you're going to be buried under snow for?
There's a lot of truck drivers that piss in bottles. I'm sure if you go to a truck stop, you can get some there.
Yeah, but I don't want the refined
stuff.
He's a raw foodist.
Yeah. Snow.
All right, Joe.
Oh, gosh, no. Please don't eat that yellow snow.
That's great.
None of us thought of that.
I know.
Yeah, you got snow all around you. It took a caller to figure that out for us.
You're in there freaking drinking dick wine.
Should we break?
Yeah, we should break because we got Robert F. Kennedy Jr. coming in. He's got a book out called Framed. And, that'll be good.
Yeah.
We're going to talk to him next. We got Florentine, who's going to be all over the place. Where are you at, Jim?
August 13th, the Treehouse in Windsor Locks, Connecticut. And then July 20th, Hard Rock Casino, Sioux City, Iowa. And then the rest of that week, the 21st to the 24th of July, Funny Bone in Omaha.
And you're doing the Whiskey Go-Go?
Yeah, I'm doing the Whiskey. And
this Friday.
This Friday with Don Jameson and Eddie Trunk. We do a version of that Metal Show Live.
No, oh, cool. I know, but it's cool you're doing it from the Whiskey
I know,
Go-Go.
We've done the Whiskey
Holy
before.
Fuck.
It's great.
I want to come watch, man. I'm going to come watch. Friday night?
Yeah, you're going to be in town?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah, because Dean's going to come by. Dean Del Rey, awesome. Buddy.
There's some history with that place.
It's great. Oh,
my
yeah.
God. Theo Von, he's awesome. They just started doing our show. We love Theo. Where are you going to be?
I'm going to be in Naples August 4th to the 7th, and then I'll be here in New York at Gotham September 2nd and 3rd.
And I enjoyed your special on Netflix. No offense.
Thanks, man. I appreciate
That's
it.
That's the name of it. No offense.
Yeah, we're getting hopefully close to taping another one here soon, so
good for you. And then feeling of course good. Jimmy's got all sorts of stuff.
Just have Columbus July 21st, Gathering of the Juggalos the 22nd, and I'm doing Toronto the 24th. But I do have a date in Montreal, I think, which I can confirm today. It's probably been confirmed. I don't have it. And my Pittsburgh and Minneapolis dates are being switched. I'll give you those dates tomorrow. But and get the UFC Unfiltered podcast.
Yeah, of course. Go to all the usual places for that. Jimmy does a great job with Matt Sarah.
Yeah, it's great.
All right, Robert F. Kennedy Jr. next.
This is Opie Radio. The show is back.
Back with Jim Florentine, Theo Von, of course, Jim Norton. And now Robert F. Kennedy Jr. making his way into the studio.
Hopefully he's in the bathroom.
Oh, now he's in the bathroom.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Okay, so 1 minute. Going. Is he taking a dump?
The royal dump.
I like to think that a Kennedy's using our bathroom to get some poo out.
Oh, no, I think somebody comes and takes the poo out of them.
You think they suck it out?
Yeah.
They got some kind of apparatus?
Yeah.
They don't even have to sit down and wipe or nothing, right?
Oh, like I wonder that. If the room smells like farts when he walks in. He's going to be like, I don't need this.
Did you just fart?
No.
Oh,
I would have.
There's been a bunch in the mix today.
I got a little excited.
There's been a bunch.
Squeak one out, please.
There's been a bunch in the mix.
I can't force it. Can you squeak one out in front of a Kennedy? That's
I have to, sure.
That's something that goes right on the resume.
Yeah. There are people
that goes
probably,
right on the resume.
They probably handle everything. They're probably hard to surprise at this point in the family history. Yeah.
He's a guy after all. He'll probably giggle.
Of course.
He'll giggle.
All right, bring him in.
He'll respect that. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. Good
Hello.
Morning, sir. How are you?
I'm great.
How are you?
What's going on, buddy?
I'm good.
How's your morning?
So far, so good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Starting the press for the new book?
Yes.
Yes.
The Today Show this morning and a couple of Connecticut radio stations.
Nice. And you do a radio show yourself, right?
Yes, I do.
It's probably a little different than ours.
I was on Air America when that closed down.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Ring of Fire.
Yeah.
Which is my show. It's been about 40 markets.
Wow.
So, Eric,
despite this voice.
Yeah, what's going on with the voice?
No, my voice is permanently injured.
From what?
It's a thing called spasmodic dystonia. It's a neurological disorder, and I got it when I was 42. I had a very strong voice before that.
Yeah.
But it's not supposed to get worse. That's the good news.
How does it get to that point? At 42, what happens? That it just
pops up.
They
don't know what causes it.
They don't.
They don't know. They think there's a genetic component, but it's not. My throat is not damaged. It's neurological signals that are coming from my brain to my throat are causing my larynx to
tighten up.
Seize up. And there's a treatment for it. I don't know if we want to go into all this, but I get Botox shots every 4 months, right through my throat into my voice box.
That's gotta hurt.
No wrinkles.
So, do you feel your throat tightening up, or do you don't even notice it?
It's uncomfortable.
It is.
Yeah, but it's, you know.
What are you gonna do?
It is. There's I have a cousin who lost a leg, so I'd think about him and think I'm pretty lucky.
Yeah. So if you were a singer in a band, your career would have been over at 42.
Yeah, I'm tone deaf, so that was never an option.
Right, that was...
can you whisper?
Yeah, does that get you...
I can whisper, but that's about it.
Yeah.
Awesome. I mean, and then my voice was... Actually, when I got this, it came on gradually, and... for a long time, and it makes my voice tremble, so it sounds like I'm about to break into tears. So I was getting letters from people who saw me on TV saying, oh, you know, it's so great that you can show your feelings and that, you know, and mainly from women. And I was thinking, you know, for every woman who wrote me, there was probably 10 guys out there who were saying, listen to this crybaby.
This guy sucks.
I would imagine the ladies would enjoy that, though, thinking that you're an emotional guy. So
I can't watch myself on TV, and no. I've never heard my radio show.
Really? You just don't want to deal with it?
I can't stand listening to my voice.
I'm the same way. I don't like listening to anything I've done or whatever. It's like, but if you wrote something, it's easy to read stuff that's written for some reason, like the editing process, but to re-listen to something, it's torture.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think you're alone with that. I think most people don't want to hear their own voice.
Yeah, or mine.
It's good to hear.
I believe that.
Can I ask a question that's all, because you're a Kennedy.
We're going to talk about this book at some point.
Of course. We're going to definitely talk about it. That ties in with this. Can I ask it? I'm not a conspiracy guy. I don't think there was a conspiracy. Why are there still documents that are sealed? I'm just curious, and I just thought of asking you that in the JFK
situation. I don't know why they keep sealing those documents, but...
Yeah, what could possibly be
I don't
be
think
in there?
That it's some giant government cover-up. I'm just wondering, what is that for what?
Well, I don't know. I mean, my father's attitude towards it was that the Warren Commission report was a shoddy piece of work. And, you know, I think in fact, he made a statement at UC Davis just before he was killed. Or he was asked by a student whether he would reopen the investigation if he were elected president. And he waited. He paused for a long time because it was an issue that was emotional for him to deal with. And it was also politically tricky for him to deal with. But then he just quietly said yes.
I've never heard that before. So he felt that it was a shoddy piece of work. And would he have reopened it, do you think, because he felt there was something else to it? Or he just felt that certain...
Well, I don't think... I think it defies, you know, that if you look at the evidence that's accumulated up till now from, you know, a million documents being released, that... the idea that it was a lone gunman is pretty hard to swallow.
Well, that's interesting to hear from you because I've actually gone full circle. I always thought it was a conspiracy. And then and Vincent Bugliosi wrote a book. And I always felt like, wow, it does seem like it was just Oswald. But to hear you saying that,
holds a little more weight when it comes from Robert F. Kennedy Jr.
There's a very good book by Jim Douglas called The Unspeakable. It's a really strong and scrupulous distillation of the evidence to date of, you know, all of the evidence that's accumulated over time on the issue. And it's a very persuasive argument.
Okay. On the unspeakable.
Things do you think would have been different if that assassination hadn't happened?
Well, you know what?
Sorry.
Are we going to have any time to talk about this book?
Yeah.
No time at all.
We're out of time.
Yeah, we're out of time. Get out of here.
Of course we will. Here's what I know about the with Michael Skakel being convicted. It's weird. There's something about it where I didn't know much about the case, and I would watch little snippets of it, and it tapped into that thing where, as a viewer, you're like, you wanted to see somebody powerful or prominent get in trouble. And I'm wondering if that's part of what drove them to go after him so
hard. Well, I think, yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the, overarching themes of this book is that the press interest in this book was a mile wide and an inch deep. It was, there were 401 reporters that were certified to cover the trial. And yet there was only one, who was Leslie Stahl, who was willing to look below, beneath this kind of flimsy orthodoxy, you know, official orthodoxy, this narrative that it was the murder was committed by an elite, effete member of the Kennedy family who then used power and connections to escape the consequences of his crime. It was an attractive narrative. It was minted originally by Mark Furman and Dominic Dunn for their own purposes, and the press never looked beyond it.
Do you think their own purposes were money, or do you think they had an ulterior motive after, after money?
Furman was trying to. Furman at that point had lost the O.J. trial, and you know, and he had, and he was trying. He had been convicted of perjury. He was ejected from ever doing, prohibited from ever doing police work again in this country. So he needed to resuscitate his career, and he did that by saying, "I'm going to solve this unsolved crime." He said from the beginning that the only reason people would buy his book is if he blamed it on, you know, somebody who could be called a Kennedy, which Michael Skakel is not a Kennedy. I never knew Michael Skakel till, and no member of my family did except for my mother, until 7 years after this murder was committed. We never knew the Skakels growing up. So the Skakels were a right-wing carbon Republicans, and they were estranged from my family. They supported Nixon 1960 election. It worked against my father in 1968. They were very funny people. In fact, George Skakel, who is Michael's uncle, and I tell this story in the book, during the 1960 inauguration, my mother got about 20 tickets for the Skakel family, very, you know, top-shelf tickets right in front of the reviewing stand. And George Skakel gave all of those tickets to inebriated hobos in downtown Washington to show his disdain for the new president. So we didn't have, so those guys were sitting in the stand in the front row seats during the, and surrounding Red Fay, who is my uncle's best friend, who was wondering, who are these guys? The Skakels had this long history of they were much wealthier than the Kennedys. They were. They had their own family gestalt and a lot of pride. And they and there was. They had not very little to do with the Kennedy family. The blaming it on Michael Skakel was the idea of Mark Furman, and he hatched a really implausible plot about how Michael could have committed the crime.
Wait, so has he not been implicated before that?
Like, Michael Skakel had never been a suspect.
It was Furman. Yeah.
His brother Tommy had been a suspect, and the primary suspect was the Skakel's tutor, who was a guy called Kenny Littleton, and there's a chapter on him in this book, and he was a really crazy guy who was implicated in around 20 serial killings of young blonde girls in places where he had lived. And so he became the primary suspect, and he had very, very odd behavior after this crime. And he was arrested on multiple times and was in and out of mental institutions and drug rehabs for the rest of his life. Michael was never a suspect, but Furman made him a suspect by writing a book about him, but the book was, Furman wrote the book in 2 months. It was not well researched. It's filled with errors. Even the police say that it's filled with errors on almost every page, you know, glaring errors. And Michael was 11 miles away with 6 eyewitnesses at the time the murder was committed. For a variety of reasons, there was a corrupt cop in Greenwich named Frank Garr, who leapt on Furman's bandwagon. And as I show, he suborned perjury. There was no evidence against Michael, no physical evidence. There was no
DNA or anything.
No DNA, no fingerprints, right. Nothing. So the only way to convict him was to find a confession. Of course, he had never confessed, but this cop suborned perjury from 3 witnesses by essentially offering them $100,000 reward money to perjure themselves. And we now have, for the first time, I published the transcripts of Frank Garr's discussions with those witnesses in this book that have never been seen before.
Who was funding the $100,000 that was given to these people?
Mrs. Moxley offered a $100,000 reward, but for a variety of reasons, Frank Gar was kind of became the liaison between the public and the reward money. So he was able to, because he was running the case, he was able to decide who was entitled to that reward.
Wow.
And he used that money, as you can, you'll see in this book, to bribe these witnesses to purge themselves.
So what did they say, the witnesses?
So they said that they heard Michael Skakel confess to the crime. But initially, when he asked them, they said, no, he never confessed. And then he said, well, I have he essentially says, and you have to read it, but I have a $100,000 reward. Why don't you think about this over the weekend, whether you want this money? And then in the, you know, one of the witnesses, the key witness over the weekend, came back on Monday and said, look, I really need the money. I just lost my job from a shoulder injury. And, you know, Frank Gar said, well, then, you know how to do it.
Was so. Furman privy to the same transcript that you're privy to? Like, did he ignore that?
No, Furman never even went that deep. I actually hired a private investigator who helped me investigate this, and I tracked down the people who actually killed Martha Moxley. I found them through a high school yearbook. One of the things that happened is Michael had a classmate who was named Tony Bryant, who was a cousin of the basketball, the Lakers star, Kobe Bryant.
Oh, wow.
And he came from a very prominent family, New York family. His brother also played for the Mavericks. And he was a star athlete at Brunswick School, where Michael's classmate. He left Brunswick, went to New York in 1974, went to New York City and went to public high school there for half a year. He became friends with the two men in that high school who ended up murdering Martha Moxley. He brought them, one was an African-American, the other was Caucasian. He brought them to Greenwich that night. They planned the murder. They picked up golf cards, clubs from the Skakel lawn. And then as they were a few minutes before they murdered Martha Moxley, Tony Bryant decided he didn't want any part of this and took a train back to New York. 2 days later, they confessed the crime to him. And over the next 3 months, they gave the details of how they killed her. And he told his mother, who was a very prominent woman in the film industry. She was one of the first African-Americans ever to win an Oscar and the first women to win an Oscar in her category. And she told him, you are black. You brought these boys to Greenwich. You are going to get blamed for this crime and you're going to go to jail if you ever talk about it. And she told him to separate himself from those boys. She sent him to school in Texas and to never speak of it again. And when I reached him, when I found him, I said to him, I got him on the phone. I said to him, this is Robert F. Kennedy Jr. I am Michael Skakel's cousin. And there was dead silence for about 6 or 8 seconds. And then he said to me, I've been waiting for 27 years for this phone call.
Wow.
And then he told me what happened over the course of 6 more phone calls. And then we went down and videotaped him in Florida. He agreed to be videotaped, but he kept backing out of the videotapes, and finally he showed up, and then he told the whole story of what happened.
And let me ask you.
I tracked down the two killers. He only knew their first names, which were Adolph and Burr. And I tracked them down using a yearbook that I got from Charles Evan Hughes High School, and one of them was named Adolph Hasbrook, and the other was Burton Tinsley. And Burton Tinsley is living in Portland, Oregon. Adolph Hasbrook is living in Bridgeport, Connecticut. I called them up, and I spoke to them on the phone, and I tape recorded surreptitiously those conversations, which is legal in New York State. And they admitted being in Greenwich that night. They admitted knowing all of the characters, and they did not admit to the crime, but they kept changing their story. And then when we subpoenaed them to testify, they both took the Fifth Amendment.
Right. Sorry.
I just want to ask, when you were talking to Tony, what was the motivation to kill her?
Adolph Hasbrook had met had seen Martha Moxley on several earlier occasions, including a Sacred Heart dance, a mixer that Tony had brought him to. And Martha actually mentions in her diary in September of 1975. And he had become obsessed with her. And he talked about nothing but her. And kept egging, kept pleading with Tony to take them back to Greenwich because he wanted to be with Martha Moxley. And he said what they said repeatedly is he wanted to take her caveman style, which according to Tony meant hitting her over the head, dragging her in the bushes, and then sexually assaulting her.
Wow.
Now, was there any physical evidence? You said obviously not against Michael, but was there any at the scene that if these guys did be forced to testify or they could take blood or hair, or was there zero physical evidence left at the scene?
There was very, the police were incredibly sloppy. The Greenwich police had a 147-man police force, and not one of them had ever investigated a mere murder before this murder occurred. So they did a lot of mistakes. They lost the golf club handle that had been protruding from Martha's body. That was lost. There was a lot of other evidence lost. There was a bloody pair of pants that was a size 36 waist. Michael Skakel was a size 28 waist. There was a bloody pair of size 13 sneakers. And these guys were huge. Both of them were over 6'3", 6'4", and weighed 250 pounds. And they were, you know, they were athletes, and they were capable of breaking a golf club, which is another story, you know. But you asked about the physical evidence. The most important physical evidence was two hairs that were found on Martha's body. One of those hairs was described as negroid. It came from a black person. Nobody was ever able to explain that. And the other was from an Asian. Now, Burton or had Asian characteristics, quote unquote. Adolph Hasbrouck is African American and Burton Tinsley is Caucasian, but is described as having either Asian or American Indian blood because, you know, from his appearance.
Do they still have those hairs or they've been lost too?
No, they destroyed those hairs while testing them, and there's no DNA, which of course. They found actually many hairs on the body. Those were the two hairs that were identified. The rest of them were all lost.
Now, so he originally gets convicted just from that that guy saying, I heard him confess, and that was it.
Yeah, that's
basically
the only thing that they had was these three confessions, which if you read the book, they're not one of the guys, was just like a low bottom junkie and a career criminal who was offered the $100,000 to testify against Michael. He didn't come forward on his own. He was found because he was high and he called a radio station and said, in Rochester, New York, his name was Coleman, and Coleman testified Michael in the pretrial hearing and at the grand jury hearing, and in both cases, one of them he was going through cold turkey. He changed his story every time he told it. He said at one point Michael had confessed 6 or 8 times, another time just once. He changed it every time he told it. When he testified in front of the grand jury, he had just done 25 bags of heroin. He testified to that. And prior to, just before the trial, he overdosed and died. So he could not be called to the trial. But the judge ruled that the prosecutors could use his earlier testimony, and they got actors to play him, and they got a very buttoned-down prosecutor to play him on the stand. And the jury said afterwards that person had such credibility that they one of the primary reasons.
Wow.
One of the things you guys will be interested in that we found, I found from Michael Baden, which was the coroner. The criminalist. Michael Skakel was a tiny kid at that time. He had not, he was just reaching puberty. He was he weighed 120 pounds. He had a 28 inch waist.
Yes, lean.
He was he looked like a little girl if you see the pictures of him in the book. But Michael Baden said that it's almost impossible. And I have a whole section on murders with golf clubs in this book. That in all of his career, 40 years career, as having seen many, many crimes that involved murders with golf club, he had never seen one broken. And that in one case, a mafia capo was beat to death in a used car dealership in New Jersey, and that there, he was beat to death with golf clubs, and that the concrete floor was chipped and cracked, that and the head was slightly dented, but the golf clubs never broke. And that in another trial, two mafiosos were testified that they had been taught by a seasoned killer to always use golf clubs because baseball bats break, but golf clubs never break. So you would need tremendous power
to break a
to
golf
be able
club.
To break a golf club in two places as this one was broken. And, you know, Michael, of course, you know, I mean, the principal exculpatory evidence is that Michael was 11 miles away with five eyewitnesses at the time the murder was convicted, and he couldn't possibly have committed the murder. There were eight eyewitnesses at the house who never saw Michael at the house where the murder was committed, and they all saw him leave, but he didn't return until 11:20, which was an hour and 20 minutes after the murder.
They're saying you got to go, but really fast, Michael Skakel did over 10 years in jail. He's out now.
Yeah.
And he's waiting for the Supreme Court to decide if they're going to try him again. Is that true?
That's right. The Supreme Court is either going to... He was released on a habeas corpus petition because his counsel was ineffective, because the judge said his imprisonment is unconstitutional because the counsel is so ineffective. The state has appealed that. He's been now out for 3 years. He wears a Lindsay Lohan bracelet on his a GPS bracelet. And if the court rules against him, if the court rules for him, he will be retried, and most likely, unless the prosecutors come to their senses and prosecute the real murderers. If they rule against him, he will serve out the rest of his term, which is 25 to life.
Well, this book will help that, certainly.
Yeah, it's called Framed, Why Michael Skakel Spent Over a Decade in Prison for a Murder He Didn't Commit. I have one final question. If there is a retrial, is that guy willing to, is the guy you spoke to who said he was waiting 27 years for that phone call, is he willing to come and testify?
He will definitely testify if they offer him immunity, which is what they should do.
Okay.
But at this point, he's saying, I'm taking the Fifth, they offer him immunity. But he already told his whole story on tape, and that tape is admissible. So, you know, we don't need him to testify, but an honest prosecutor would offer him immunity and then, you know, prosecute the two guys who actually murdered Martha Moxley.
Well, we just got this book last night, which is why we didn't read it, but this seems fascinating. So, you know, good luck to you with this, and hopefully now that you've turned me around.
I want to say the book was embargoed. Nobody was allowed to see it till today.
So okay, cool. I'm glad I didn't lie.
You have a written excuse for not doing your homework.
It sounds like it's going to be a fascinating read, though.
Thank you so much.
Hey, thanks, guys.
Yeah, Robert F. Kennedy Jr.
Thanks, Robert.
You want to wrap up, Jimmy? We're good?
We can come back and do it if you want.
We'll come back and wrap up. Stay there. Oh, my God, what just Doesn't happened matter. In the studio. It's... Oh, wow. I hope you're still tuning in.
So
we
close.
Have Robert.
Wow.
E-Rock.
I'm stunned.
I love you. And
that,
I'm
not,
telling
not,
you,
whatever, that was wrong.
I'm
that
telling
was
you,
terrible.
You had the worst timing probably I've ever seen.
So close.
Robert F. Kennedy Jr. just is opening up about the Kennedy assassination. He's convinced that JFK was absolutely done in by a lot of different, how would you say it, different entities.
Different forces. Yeah.
Different forces. And he's really getting into it. And he's like, fuck the rest of my press. He's really in the moment. He's telling us. And then E-Rock out of nowhere goes,
one minute, we're back.
1 minute, we're back. And then Robert F. Kennedy Jr. goes, anyway, and walks out.
Take care, guys. Now, I know we have a job to do, and E-Rock has a responsibility.
But at that point, Travis would just end the show. Fuck it.
The nephew of JFK is talking, the son of Robert Kennedy, the attorney general at the time, is talking about the murder and what might be a play. And a lot of it was stuff we'd already heard.
But it's not read that and fascinating. Go,
like, maybe we should just go to a bit.
You'll probably have another chance to talk to a Kennedy.
Or just end the show at that point. Who cares? Like, we were just coming back for stupid plugs.
Your timing was unbelievable.
I've never seen it. I mean,
and his voice is shitty, so he's kind of like he's struggling to try to tell us.
He did have other press to do, and he wasn't going to stay for an hour. But the fact that he was so he was really into talking about it.
I was very engaging.
His voice got very clear there for a second.
Oh, yeah, boy, does he have a lot of people to blame.
It was almost like you were ready to have a threesome with two tens. And your friend walks in and goes, hey, your wife called. The kids are crying. She wants you home. And the girls walk away.
All we hear is 1 minute and you're back.
and the chicks just leave.
Pick that as his he's got to get out of here. And just like, literally walked out without saying goodbye.
It's like when there's snow everywhere and you choose to drink piss, brother. That's what it's like.
I think he was a bit insulted, actually.
No, I just told him, hey, so he goes, we had to leave anyway. He said goodbye.
Yeah, right.
But
but he was talking about the CIA and God.
This is not just
Bay
someone
of
who
pigs. And wow.
Yeah. Johnson. He's Lyndon B. Johnson.
Alan Dulles.
Yeah.
Who talks about Alan Dulles? He's talking about Alan Dulles.
He's talking
Do
about
you understand how
things.
Terrible that was?
I don't care.
You should care.
No, either do it on the air or don't say we're coming back. And if you want to continue a conversation during the break, then wave it off and say we're done.
Sometimes we're talking about the JFK assassination.
Sometimes in life you have to realize that you fucked up. And not, I know that technically you have a job to do.
I'm not saying I didn't fuck up here,
that's
but
all
I'm
there
also
is.
Not saying I don't
cannot
care
understand.
Why you're upset on that.
I think
you should understand. You should care to understand what the implication of Robert Kennedy's son,
right,
really discussing the Kennedy assassination,
right,
things that he's not saying publicly, to not understand, hey, this is a moment that was not planned.
He actually said to us, I would never say his on
the
air.
I guess he doesn't want to go
right
down
but
the rabbit hole publicly.
But certainly we would discuss the conversation we were having with him. I felt like he was getting to the moment where he was going to say, I feel like blank did this.
Yeah.
And then all I hear is, 1 minute and you're back.
Because you have been saying 2 minutes, 1 minute, we're back.
He had beautiful eyes, too.
Gorgeous eyes.
I'm stunned.
Like fucking gems.
I'd love to have one of his eyes, dude.
Yeah.
I'd put one of his eyes in my mouth, bro. It was beautiful.
And you couldn't have gotten to say that. This wasn't like a typical thing where, hey, it was an actor talking about that girl he fucked. This was one of those things where, again, he doesn't want to say it all publicly because he probably doesn't know who killed him. He wasn't speculating on who killed him. It wasn't like it wasn't that like he was about to go, and I think it was.
Right.
But it was just the idea that a guy this close to that event and that this involved in it with this much knowledge of it was saying things that I hadn't been thinking, so I was certainly willing to listen to it.
Oh my God, you got a Kennedy talking about his uncle's
assassin. Not a Kennedy. Robert Kennedy
right,
Jr.
Well, he did preface, that's my uncle.
So. Yeah.
He said, my uncle.
Like
my
he was about to
dead.
Pull like some black and white photos out of his breast pocket. That's what it seemed like.
Do you know what it's like to hear someone say, and so and so hated my uncle?
Yes, which he did say.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there like, holy fuck, this is amazing. E-Rock didn't find it amazing. Why didn't you find that amazing?
I think the best thing he should have done is probably whispered in your ear and said, hey, we'll come back in a minute.
We're just coming back.
So you could have made that decision.
Said, what do you want?
We didn't even have to come back. We were coming back just to get dumb plugs in.
Okay.
That was the only reason we were coming back. We could have easily ended the show after the Robert F. Kennedy Jr. interview.
He knows a lot, too. You can tell.
Oh, he is angry, man. He's a CIA, Bay of Pigs.
We'll never get that chance again.
Oh, the mafia.
Well, you can smell the gunpowder on his breath.
Trained killers, Fidel Castro. This is the stuff this guy's telling us.
And again, whether or not he's right or wrong, who knows? Because again, he may not be right just because he's Kennedy's son. But to hear him discuss it,
it's a moment in time you'll never get again.
Never.
Ever.
I would have blown off the rest of the day. Everything
Without
else would have been on hold.
That's a moment where you got
to continue that conversation.
And his cologne, too. Do you smell his cologne?
I
was too busy looking into his
dreamy that
eyes.
And know that there's something.
Whirlpools.
Whirlpools.
Of truth.
You could have played a bit there, and you know that. A bit could have been played there. What you say we were going to come back. Why couldn't you have just played a bit? I don't get it.
Eric, what's up?
With cologne,
why don't you care about this?
I mean, how
this?
Do you not think of that? I'm not shitting all over you, but I can't wrap my head around it.
Beautiful eyes.
Okay, fair enough. I fucked up.
But wouldn't you? I don't know. All right. I mean, I would have just at that point said the guy's got this. Fuck it. If Travis ended the show or played a bit, who cares?
Soft voice.
We have a Kennedy.
10:37.
We have a Kennedy talking about his uncle's assassination.
No, we don't have a Kennedy. We have Robert Kennedy Jr.
I was so close.
You
can smell the espionage on him, bro. You could smell it if you were right over here.
Wow.
He wasn't going to, again, we didn't, there's not anything we missed information.
It was just fascinating.
It was just fascinating.
To hear his take on it.
Yes, to hear somebody that close to it discuss it.
So you could have just ended the show with like a bit and that could never come back?
The Cubans, the Mafia, trained killer, CIA, Fidel Castro with that voice. And we're just like, we're all just, and then none of us is speaking. We're just staring at the guy.
I was asking him a couple of questions like about this or that.
Well, Jimmy was leading a little bit.
But just like hey, to do, and then let him talk.
Yeah.
And I asked him about Earl Warren. I went to, you know, Earl Warren, talked about Earl Warren. Now I'm all these names that you know from this thing.
Johnson.
And none of it was said that, like, we hadn't heard before, but it was still just fascinating to hear.
Yeah.
And sometimes in a moment, man, there's a weird thing that happens where by doing it, like you said, you break a spell. Well, you there's these weird moments you have where you're not going to...
He was in the moment.
Something is broken. He knew he had to leave.
Yeah, but he didn't care. He was really enjoying just talking to us about it.
He was enjoying it. He wasn't saying anything to be quoted for the rate, you know, literally.
It was a special.
You don't have Iraq to turn the cameras off? That would be hilarious. Because here, 1 minute and we're back. And then Robert F. Kennedy Jr. just walking out.
And he was like, I wouldn't say this on air. That's what he said. Remember that?
Yeah. I wouldn't have played anything he said anyway because he was talking privately.
No, I wouldn't do that to him. But the moment where E-Rock just yells, 1 minute and we're back. And then this guy just hustles out immediately and just drops everything he was saying.
Yeah, he was right in mid-sentence and he left.
He literally...
Maybe he felt bad, like, because he kind of shut it down when we were interviewing because he wanted to get to the books. And then he said, all right, off the air, I'm going to tell these guys.
You know what I was thinking at that moment? And I'm not even joking. I'm like, thank God Tony Robbins was in here to help Jimmy with his anger issues. I think it would have played out a little differently.
It's not even anger, really. It's more just I don't know how to process it.
Yeah.
I'm not mad at E-Rock. I love E-Rock. I don't know how to
look
process.
Look at the smile on Roland's face.
This is why I'm sick. I think it's the best thing that ever happened to me.
God. You got to focus.
In a twisted way, I think it was, oh my God.
Nah, it's
stuck. We have the audio?
You going to be okay, Jimmy? Tools is
running. Oh, can we play, go listen really
Oh, you do
fast.
Have the audio?
We have the audio, so we can put it up the picture.
No, but play right now.
It takes a while to eject.
Oh, my God. All right, we'll play it tomorrow.
We have the audio of what?
It's on a totally different computer. It records.
Watch the audio come back all edited and adjusted.
Can we get it tomorrow? But I agree with Jimmy. He was talking about this in private, so I don't want to like...
Nothing he said.
Yeah, but I mean, if you beep something or whatever, just I need the setup, though, of him like in the middle of talking, and then Eric just... we'll figure something out.
Can we just... I would almost rather just play E-Rock saying... I literally don't want to play one... No, I don't want to play 1 second of anything he said in private. Like, not even an incidental word. There's something violating about it.
All right.
I would rather just have...
You just want the drop.
Because literally he was saying it so privately that I feel it's a violation, even if it's one word.
Yeah, we just want the audio of your monumental fuck-up.
All I want is E-Rock.
The 1 minute and then him walking out. And you're like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Like that.
You're like the Lee Harvey of conversations, bro.
What made it great, too, was because, you know, his voice, he's talking a little lower because that's how he could, you know, have a conversation. And then E-Rock's booming, 1 minute and we're back!
Oh, yeah, it was prison. It was prison chatter. Wow. That was Shawshank stuff,
What do you think, Theo? Were you shocked when he popped in with that?
Oh, I thought it. I thought we were going to get somewhere, dude. I could see the past to kind of flow.
Even if we didn't, it was just fascinating.
That was beautiful.
It was one of those moments where you're like, holy fuck, you got to, you know...
And he Robert felt F. different. Jr. You could tell he felt more chill, comfortable.
He felt like he was just talking because we asked a couple of questions where he knew that we had read up on the assassination and we're asking legitimate questions about it. God.
I mean,
I just don't know how to. Certain things in life happen where you're just not sure what to do with it.
Like wrestling, like professional wrestling. I don't know.
That's what Tony Robbins said. Go home and lay down and think of three things that you're grateful for.
Yeah, well, I am bothered by this for 5 hours. I learned.
Here's what Tony Robbins would say.
I would test the pop quiz.
If I said to Tony, now what do you do in this situation right now? He would say, you have to feel better. Strangle that idiot.
He has a 90-second rule in the house. 90 seconds, you have to move on and get over it.
Does he really?
Yeah, that's what he was saying earlier. Yeah, that's what Tony was saying. If there's family problems,
when's the last
arguing.
Time Tony talked to Robert Kennedy about the assassination of his uncle?
Oh, my God.
E-Rock is really in the dumps, so I feel bad now, man.
And why'd you say I don't care at first?
You should care a lot.
That's really strange to me.
Not that you should cry about
that's
it.
That's really strange
But you
to
should
me.
Care. Like, you should go, wow, that was something that was kind of really very, very unique.
The millennials. He's a millennial.
I didn't read at all.
No, he said, I don't care because he had a job to do to get the show back.
No, but he didn't care because
Ope's right, because I knew you guys were in the moment and I knew you weren't going to be paying attention. I knew we only had one break left, so I was pretty much watching Travis the entire time to let you guys
Travis's
know.
Oh, fault.
But you should have Travis's fault. At all.
I had plenty of stuff ready to go in case you guys were continuing to talk.
Yeah, well, they should have played.
No, the interns never start the recording, so we don't have Pro Tools either.
What?
We didn't. Pro Tools was not started this morning, so we don't have the audio of that either.
I told you immediately. What did I tell you? It's a cover up.
I don't know. I guess they forgot.
Wow. It's the warrant commission.
Who's supposed to tell the interns to do that?
Wait, interns are responsible for turning on Pro Tools?
Yeah, they hit record.
And who's supposed to tell them to do that or no?
Well, I was telling them to do it. They didn't do it this morning. But
I knew it.
The intern boss is seated right behind you.
How come you didn't tell him to turn it?
Because I didn't think of that. I don't usually deal with the Pro Tools, but, you know, I guess it's all our fault.
Cover up.
No, not cover up. It's just...
Not from you. I'm just saying overall. This Kennedy's, everything, immediately, the audio is going.
I'm not taking blame. I'm getting the warrant report going.
Me and Florentine are getting haircuts today, aren't we,
That's
Florentine?
Right. That's right. I'm paying for mine now.
Get rid of your bangs.
No, bangs over Brooklyn he's taking me to. That's where I want to go. I want to go to Long Island.
So what you told the intern
Jersey,
and then why didn't they turn it on when you told them to?
Oh, I tell them to turn it, start it up every day. There has been some difficulties where they've walked in, they've started, but today they didn't check it at all, so none of it was recorded.
That happens.
See, I want to go watch porn now. This is the problem, man.
Really?
I'm gonna go eat breakfast instead.
This will lead you to porn.
I just feel like, yeah, you hit some moments in the day, I'll be fine.
Oh my God, that was just beyond amazing how that all just went down.
Beautiful eyes, that guy, though. You see
Gorgeous.
That?
Gorgeous. My God, like an infinity pool.
Makes you hate the rich.
I felt like I was in the Caribbean.
Oh, yeah.
Fuck.
You know what? You
sunken ships. He had sunken ships in his eyes.
I'll be really honest. And it's not. I just Googled Robert Kennedy Jr. discusses JFK assassination. Mm-hmm. RFK Jr., my father was convinced rogue CIA killed his brother. So he has discussed this before. So it was still shitty time. No, but I'm saying it wasn't like we had this moment that no one else has ever, you know, it was just interesting to hear him talking.
Oh, I had no doubt that he probably discussed it before, but we were just fortunate enough to have him discussing it to us personally.
But Pro Tools being off, like the fact that
the interns were working on something else this morning.
Of course.
What were they working on?
I think they were working on audio, right?
Yeah, they were cutting show audio.
For our show, though?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Best of. What are you doing?
I'm just saying. Were they cutting our show, though?
Yeah.
Okay. Because interns have been cutting other shows before.
What other shows?
Wait, I learned from Tony Robbins today. I know what's going on. This is more about the posters than anything else today, isn't it?
Now, Paul, what do you say?
I've seen interns cutting other shows during the time when our show's on air.
Espionage.
I have seen that.
But see, they're having an issue about posters. It has nothing to do with interns.
What kind of posters?
There might have been some posters that were taken down.
Ghostbusters posters?
And E-Rock's very mad at Paul about it. And there might have been some text messages going back and forth, according to Paul.
What happened?
Someone was a little frustrated that I took down the comic book posters off the office walls. Someone was just a little frustrated and got a little texty last night. But then I walk in this morning, and how am I supposed to know the date or protect myself in the rain when my umbrella and calendar have been ripped and thrown out?
Yeah.
Yay, Paul has a bit.
What, Eric?
I said, yeah, you got
it. Oh, you're here? You're not at Comic-Con or working on your show right now?
No, I'm not.
Oh, okay, that's good to know. We'll see you at Comic-Con next week, though, right?
Right, thanks for listening.
Have fun.
Wow.
Beef.
Well, beef, it's about the posters. I told you. There's always something underneath. I learned that from Tony Robbins.
But did you know they were Eric's posters and he probably wanted them up? Why'd you take them down?
Yeah, why would you take his posters
down? Because
they're
stupid to hang up in a fucking office. Like Jim said with Piff the Magic Dragon, it's not a fucking fort.
It's not a fucking fishbowl either where everyone has to view you.
That's why we have
our
fucking banners up with the logo of the channel up. Like everybody
also,
else down there.
My office before it was your office, and if I want to hang shit up, I'll hang shit up.
All right, that's fine. I took them down. And if they get hung back up again, I'll take them back down again. They were perfectly rolled, and I got a text, "Who the fuck do you think you are touching my shit? You're going to have a big problem tomorrow." And it was that a threat? And you're like, what's the company going to think with taking down posters? They were neatly rolled, Eric. Relax. Calm down.
Okay, you're done with your wrestling posters. You're done with your wrestling promo here? No, I'm just saying.
You didn't tell me about it. You never told me you took it down.
Yeah,
I
because,
found out
because
after the
if
fact.
I would have told you, you would have said, don't touch my fucking shit. All right. This fucking shit. You flip out all the time. You never say something
stuff.
Calm, cool, and collective how an OM is supposed to act.
This is what we hushed Kennedy for?
No, this I wasn't bringing any of this.
Did he
up.
Take care of your umbrella like you took care of his posters?
No, he threw them out. And then in rage, he threw them out in a rage yesterday because he was having a little hissy fit, a little bitch fit.
Yep.
And then this morning I walk in, and guess what? The fucking calendar is up with tape all over it. Like he neatly picked out the garbage and pieced it together.
Yeah, I felt bad.
You take this calendar back.
Wait, you ripped up his calendar?
Wow. Well, I kind of swatted at it when it? It's a dumb hockey calendar.
It's
and
a Flyers
I
calendar.
Swatted at it when I was pissed, and then when it hit the...
like swatting at airplanes?
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, it pretty much ripped in half when I swatted at it, because it was taped to his cabinet, and I just grabbed and threw it out. And then later I found out that he didn't rip down the posters, because I had no idea
No, because I'm a
happened.
Fucking professional.
You're also an idiot, but...
Okay. The next creative decision you make is what fucking Funkos to put on your fucking Instagram. Why is it... Okay. Or how many fucking lemons to put in your fucking iced tea for his executive
decision.
Are
you jealous? What's wrong here?
No, nothing's wrong.
What are you doing?
Nothing's wrong. I'm perfectly
making,
fine.
You have
because you
weird,
sent me a text yesterday.
Anger.
You sent me a text yesterday saying, who the fuck took down my posters?
Right,
and I said,
exactly.
Guess what? I did. And then, who the fuck do you think you are to touch my shit? The company is going to this, this, and this. You're going to be in real trouble tomorrow. Guess what, Eric? I'm not. The posters were neatly put down and taken away.
Nobody
and then you had a hissy bitch fit. Let's see what the company has to say about property damage.
Oh, shit.
Okay.
Not good.
Go ahead.
Not good.
So the intern.
I wouldn't call a Flyers calendar a property damage
right.
If he ripped a little corner.
But how am I supposed to protect myself from the rain with my umbrella gone?
Put one of his posters
on the umbrella. What did he do with the umbrella?
Hey,
I don't know. It's disappeared. That wasn't neatly taped.
Where's the umbrella, Eric?
It was in the garbage.
Yeah, was it a nice umbrella?
It was like a black and white umbrella.
I don't even use it.
You can always drink your urine if it gets bad in the rain, brother.
I grabbed it because where the calendar landed and the pages were, I just picked it all up and the umbrella was there. I threw it all in the garbage can.
So let me ask you the question. The interns were working on best stuff for the show today.
Yep.
Okay, so they weren't working on E-Rock show or any other show. They were doing
I've seen them before working on Eric's show during show hours.
Yeah, when we need to have them do something, they can't just be sitting around doing nothing. So I give them...
Well,
friends
they'd be
the
working
show,
the phones instead
show,
of having Travis back in there working the phones the whole time.
Yeah, isn't there stuff they could be doing for the show, though, even if they're
and
not?
One of them has been on the phones today.
I've been told that they've never worked on your audio.
Okay.
Who's saying they never worked on your audio?
Sorry, Paul.
They are.
No, I've seen it, though.
But the interns are now saying that they've never worked on.
No, not these interns, but other interns
past
I've seen working.
Past interns.
Okay.
Yes.
E-Rock, is it true or is it a lie?
I constantly give them stuff to do. Otherwise, they're sitting around here doing nothing, and we have to justify them doing something.
Have they ever prepared your iced tea for you?
Every morning.
This is the Warren, Commission now.
We were going to end the show.
Yes, great.
If we just ended the show, we would still be talking to Robert F. Kennedy Jr.
It's 10:50, so you have 1 minute to end.
We have, it's funny, I feel better about it now since I've looked up on Google and realized he's disgusted. I didn't think he was going to give us any secrets. It was just an interesting moment to have.
You know what? You're right. Looking back at it and understanding your reasoning for it, I fucked up.
Are you a bit jaded because there's so many famous people that come through here? It's not every day a Kennedy comes through here. When I see a Kennedy sitting down, I'm like, holy fuck. Right away, right? You're just like, that's like royalty
in this
country.
But those guys are very easy to talk to because there's so much
great
family history. And so they're all good talkers.
Yes.
And this case is so famous. So he was very easy to interview. It was just...
I'm not going to lie to you. I didn't really give a fuck about the case or the book, but how he described it, I think I want to read this thing now.
It's interesting.
He really put it on the table.
Handsome guy, I thought.
Yeah. Handsome, those eyes.
Oh, the skin, too. Like a beach.
The nose
like
was a little fucked up, though. You noticed that, right?
Yeah, but I didn't...
A little fucked up.
I could barely see it.
Because you were too busy on the eyes?
I was lost in there.
He's...
Like wizard eyes.
I can barely hear you guys just talking in the distance. I was so deep in them.
Theo's going to be masturbating later.
Well, hey, to this show, though, now. To JFK. I'm going to go watch JFK.
All right, well, that took a fucking crazy turn. All right.
Are E-Rock Paul a good place or no?
I'm fine.
I think they're in a good place.
Cool.
I never have a problem.
Paul's very even keeled.
Yes. All right. Robert F. Kennedy Jr., thank you. The book's called Framed.
I'm going to read this, but I'm glad there was an embargo on it. We didn't get that. Was why. No wonder.
We got so much stuff, though, man.
I can't wait to read this.
I had to go watch Ghostbusters because we got him coming in tomorrow. We got
Who's Paul coming Feig. Tomorrow?
Paul Feig.
Paul Feig.
Yeah, Paul Feig. And yeah, then we did the Tony Robbins documentary.
That was good.
Yeah. All right, Florentine, what do you got? Let's go around the table.
God damn it, I wish we had you breaking in. I wish we had that moment.
My latest special, I'm Your Savior, is on iTunes now.
Were all the cameras off?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I always told him, I thought that was kind of me a while ago. I was like, I think I was very adamant. Not that Paul's leaving mom, but just we always have to have them all. It's, again, it's a fucking invasion of people's private shit. But now I'm really regretting that.
I'm really regretting that. I just think that was hilarious.
They were both great guests, man. They were, Tony Robbins was awesome, and Robert.
And you guys are great today, man. Theo and Florentine.
I didn't count you guys.
Well, Florentine, what do you got, buddy?
I'm Your Savior. My latest special is on iTunes now. You can get it there. Funny Bone in Omaha next week, July 21 through 24. And July 20, Hard Rock Casino, Sioux City, Iowa.
JimFlorentine.com for everything. Jim Florentine. Jimmy, what do you got, buddy?
Just the UFC podcast with Matt Serra. And my looks like Minneapolis and... Pittsburgh. I'll have a date for you tomorrow, exactly as to when they're going to be. I think in September, we're pushing them to the fall, which will be perfect because I'm going to be shooting again, hopefully early October. So I'll announce that very soon once the date is locked in. So I'm just leading up to another shoot.
Nice.
And I also got Columbus and Toronto coming up.
Theo Von.
Yeah.
Are you in town all week?
Yeah, I'm going to be in town next couple of days.
All right, we'll try to get you in one more day because we don't see you around these parts too often.
Yeah, you don't. I appreciate it, man. Good to see you guys today.
All right, what do you got?
I'll be in Naples August 4th through 8th, New York here, Gotham September 2nd and 3rd, and Dallas September 15th through 18th.
That's it.
Addison Improv.
E-Rock, final word to you.
You can catch my show Friday, 6 p.m. Eastern.
I didn't want to plug. E-Rock. I wanted to go fuck yourself or something.
No. We can catch.
Jim made a valid point, and I've seen the error of my way.
Jack Ruby.
I don't like the way you made singular way, like it was only one error. He said, I've seen the error of my way. It's ways,
E-Rock. Of that particular way.
Okay, fair enough.
Yes. Wow. Only one at a time.
I'm not excusing everything else. Just that particular
thing. I think that one should have been so obvious.
Yeah.
That there was a moment going on.
Well, you got a story for the ages now.
Like cologne.
I wish we had the audio of you just belting out 1 minute on tour back. And the killer is.
I know.
1 minute.
I could almost make out the silhouette of whoever it was up there.
Right. 1 minute. Oh, my God. That hearing we might have had that audio made me very happy.
What made me very happy, Jim Norton did not know what to do with himself for about a minute there.
When
he was pacing, he went out the door, he came back in like
Jackie Gleason.
He didn't fucking know what to do with himself
for about a minute there. 1 minute and we're back. Robert Kennedy Jr. was out of the door within 3 seconds.
Yeah, he was
out the door.
Mid-sentence, basically.
Yeah. I just grabbed him as he was walking away. I said, hey, thank you for coming. Right. He's like, yeah, it was fine.
Can you imagine that guy's life he's had, probably?
Well, you read the sheet.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Exactly. A little heroin action in there.
Law school. All sorts London. Of stuff. Harvard.
Really, really, an amazing life.
Just the thread count on his bed sheets. Can you even fathom the sea of comfort he sleeps in? I was raised in.
That's right.
A little different than
slaves, probably.
A little different than your upbringing.
Yeah,
a little bit.
Although they have a lot of problems too, man. You got that kind of money, Kennedys. There's all that weird stuff that comes with that. Again, like you said, heroin. Look at John Jr. I mean, again, a privileged life, but you know, he had to fly private because people bugged him on flights. But talking about how wonderful his father was, like he just wants to be left alone and relax.
Right. Yeah.
People like me coming up.
Plus, a lot of tragedy in that family, too, man. That's going to take its toll.
I would love to really talk to him. I mean, the pressure of going into politics, he never really did it. He sort of a little bit here and there, but everyone looking at you going, you're supposed to be the next one.
Maybe
they looked at him for a while. Like you're going to be the next one in the family that really goes for it in politics.
We probably had a lot of skeletons, too. Like they said, that diary got leaked,
right?
Which I think is disgusting that they printed some of his diary.
New York Post, repulsive. Right?
Who's his diary?
Got stolen.
That was the Post again, right?
It's so repulsive
that
they printed some of that. private stuff.
Yeah, there you go. New York Post.
Much for vulture. The only time that's relevant is if it's detailing corruption or something you've done that affected you the way you deal with the public. Then it's relevant information. But if it's just you fucking different girls, that's fucking sickening.
He wrote about it in his diaries. Sickening. And the Post decided, let's print this shit up.
How repulsive. I wonder if they'd do that if it was Rupert Murdoch stuff.
Fuck no. All right, guys. Hit that fucking button.